Okay, so I guess we can start. And we can start from by spending experience points. Experience points. Oh. Yeah. What? Sorry, Sean? Were you saying something?
I said, oh yeah. Oh, yeah. I've got spreadsheets upon spreadsheets for all this stuff now.
Mm-hmm. So, Gustav, what about your XP?
I'm spending 100 to become a physician.
Ooh, nice. Nice. So you're officially a qualified doctor right now.
Working on it. As qualified as it can be in the old world, I guess.
Yeah. Johannes, what about you?
I am going to spend 100 to take charm, because apparently I did not have charm before.
Nice. That's a very useful skill. It gives you bonus to your fellowship, right? If I recall correctly.
Yes, I believe. It's something like that. Mm-hmm. I don't really know, but I read it.
I've heard it's pretty good. That's all.
Yeah.
I've heard that it works well with them women. Supposedly, of course.
Yeah, well, that is definitely part of my design is to. And I was telling the guys that maybe I'll
become a seductress.
Well, to schmooze Hannah Edberg some more.
Yeah, and you know, maybe marry yourself into a rich merchant family.
Yeah, just marry yourself.
Yeah, marry yourself. It's like masturbation, but with marriage. So, yeah, yes. Sounds good. So, finally, Lambert, what are you going to buy?
I'm picking up a trade skill for calligraphy.
Calligraphy? Okay, cool. Okay.
To do no good with it.
Yeah.
If we give Marla 5 toughness, that'll be all her numerical stats for camp follower.
Be my guest. I mean, it's up to you guys. You have her XP. You can advance her in any way you like. Okay.
Like, so for here on out from Marla, she is just on skills and talents for camp follower.
So these are only things left for her, right?
Yeah, okay. but there are a lot of skills and talents, and one of them is a trade that she has to specialize in.
Mm-hmm.
So that's probably something she would have to like do over several sessions or something. If it was a PC.
Yeah. Also, Lambert, remember that you took the calligraphy thingy, but you also need to practice it a bit. I mean, we can just say that right before you go to sleep, you draw for like half an hour or something like that.
Calligraphy is the act of writing fancy.
Oh, yeah, it's my mistake. Okay.
Cartography is what you're thinking of.
Mm.
So,
okay, so right.
So I have a camp follower pulled up. She could learn animal care or drive, charm or evaluate, gossip, haggle, perception, search, and any one of trade, armorer, boyer, cartographer, cook, gunsmith, herbalist, merchant, smith, tailor, or weaponsmith. So she can go like in several directions, you know what I mean?
Well, I mean, keeping with her character, I think, you know, for example, charm would probably be pretty good. But I mean,
the trade though is like where it could get crazy, because she could be like a tailor, she could be a smith, weaponsmith, boyer,
yeah,
cartographer, cook.
Cook would also work then, probably. Tailor.
Fuck that! I can't afford that shit.
And
Jesus,
she has to learn a language too, either Breton, Kislevian, or Italian.
Yeah.
So she's going to be a cultured woman by the end of this career.
A cultured prostitute. Oh, sorry, we call them escorts now, I believe.
Sex worker.
Sex workers, that's right. My bad. So anyway, I started blasting.
Town pump.
What? Sorry?
That's what we call them, town pump.
Jesus. in Po, I mean, okay, that's this is going to be horrible, but I once heard a very, very, very nasty description of a, you know, of a college girl who sleeps with all the guys on her ear. Mm-hmm. And in Poland, we call them college or university bicycles, because everyone rides
them. Village bicycle. Everyone gets a ride.
Yeah. That was horrible, honestly, when I heard it for the first time. But anyway, we start now. Thank you. So, Sean, you're still making notes. You have the document ready. And last time we did stuff, but I forgot exactly what kind of stuff.
So last time we did stuff. Okay.
Yeah, I mean,
we can work with that, guys.
Yeah.
All right. Well, let me open up since I just copied it over this morning. Gosh, I don't even remember what we did.
I mean, Gustav and Johannes, you were at Schnitzer's house.
Right, and I was getting ready to throw the servant out the window, but then Gustav gave him 12 gold, and immediately he was very helpful.
Oh yeah, I remember that. What?
Dude, they'll just come back for more money.
Oh, I mean,
no, because we left the place. Let's see. Boo, boo, boo. Oh, and then Lambert went to the guy with the, I think it was a sheep's head or a goat's head, not a horse's head, and I thought we put it on the dining room table, not in his bed. But anyway, he went to the bed in the head in the bed guy's house, and I guess tried to be sneaky, but ended up just laying his cards on the table, and so apparently this guy now is gonna deal with Dankmar.
I honestly think that Lambert was pretty successful with the guy
inciting a gang war.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, he was successful. What he was not successful in is convincing him that he was
from the Union.
Yeah. There was something funky that happened, I remember him boning Thumerall. I can't remember what it was now, though. But
I remember that Lambert wanted to pick up a piece of paper or parchment with his handwriting, and I think he just failed to notice any.
Okay. The witch hunter talked to us, but didn't arrest us. And apparently, the tattoo is a Myrmidian symbol.
There's also not a lot of information we withheld that's like serious. You know what I mean?
Right.
So I'm not too worried, but it could come back on us.
I mean, you've learned that. That the guy who killed like lots of his family members, Gaston, also known as, apparently, according to notes, Fuck Machine.
Yes.
This one's not on me, by the way. he was, of course, he was an academic. I mean, he studied in Aldorf, and he had this scorpion tattoo. And it was connected to, I believe, a society, a learning society, in university, in the Aldorf University, which is, you all know that, I mean, without any rules, it's one of the best schools, best academia in the old world. And the tattoo was rather weird, because I believe it was a scorpion inserted into a sun, with rays coming in all directions. I don't think there was ever a mention of Myrmidia, well, except for the fact that, of course, sun is one of the symbols of this goddess.
I have in the notes that the witch hunter told us.
Oh, okay, yeah. Myrmidian symbol. Okay, well, he could have said that. And his last squeeze was Guerina Akner, a minor noble. And she lives somewhere to the south.
And we took all the letters to that effect. All of his love letters to the various ladies.
There was invitations to a party or something, right?
But there was something about a party or a club at the university, right? Was it Red Dragon or something like that?
Yes, it was. It was invite to Red Dragon. Envelope written by Professor Albert Neumeier, addressed to legal guardian that Gaston is skipping class and grades down. When he does come to class, he sleeps, irritable, has outbursts, violent with other student. He's a promising man, interested in geography. It was dated 2 weeks ago, 2 weeks after invite to Red Dragon. You also found scraps of white cloth, and you determined, which the servant later confirmed, that they were left by one of his lovers, who apparently had to come through the window because, Gaston was strange like that. Four tickets, passes to a club, very fancy paper, handwritten, very fine calligraphy, code Golden Triangle, gold leaf on the logo, and of course you found a writing kit which Johannes put in his pocket. So that's that. And I think we've left just when you all returned to the Shepherd's Wand. I mean, Lambert was there first, and I think he spoke to Finrone, or maybe it was before he went to the lamp guy. His name is Konrad Kinnick. But right now, Gustav, Johannes, and Marla, you all return to your base of operations, so to speak, located near the Street of 100 Taverns, or Street of 1000 Taverns, depends. Both names apply. And you enter the room. You enter the room where Lambert Cherryheart is sitting and minding his own business. On to you.
Hey, what's up? What's up, Lambert?
Well, I think
does he have a mark on his face from when he got slapped?
Did I get slapped?
By your uncle.
Oh, by Dankmar. Oh.
Yeah.
That was a while ago, wasn't it?
It was
two sessions ago, but it was actually just like a couple hours ago.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So I guess that you probably have a red mark on your face, I would say. Because Dankmar slapped you hard.
Can we test for perception on that or something? Or
see how much it hurt my pride?
Yeah, okay. Let's say that you can.
Unless you're going to volunteer that he slapped the shit out of you.
You have plus 10% because it's rather easy to notice.
Oh!
Nice. Johannes?
Somebody beat his ass.
Marla also spotted the slap.
I'm going to take fingerprints.
Johannes, you're rolling?
Nah, I don't care.
Okay. So, Gustav, you saw what...
one of you guys doesn't care.
You see that left side of Lambert's face is red. Like, really red.
What happened to you?
I don't want to talk about it.
No. Well, is it going to happen to us?
What? Getting slapped?
Oh.
I could do it right now. If that's what you're into.
I'm not going to say that joke, says Marla. But you're fine, right, Lambert?
Yeah, sure.
Alright. You know, I'll...
It's as dejected as hell.
I'll go downstairs and ask Finrone for some food of us. You boys can speak between yourselves. I think this is what the Estalians call the macho thing, stuff like that. I'll be right back.
Yeah.
And she just, leaves the room, closes the door behind her.
As she leaves, I will just say, once the door closes, yeah, Dankmar slapped me. Because I accused him, I was being an asshole. You guys know how I am. I was being an asshole to him, and granted, it was necessary, and he was being a total little shithead for dragging the entire family into the drug trade. So yeah, I may have incited a drug war. That's nice.
What?
What? Did I just? Dunkmar slapped me.
Start at the beginning.
Let's go back to the drug war part.
I kind of might have tipped the hands of a previous contract. You remember that guy? Yeah, that silly guy that we left that head at. And that was so much fun. All that stuff.
Yeah.
Jeep's head. Yeah. I kind of insinuated that it was my uncle that did that.
I'm going to go downstairs and find a drink. Yeah.
Gang wars!
Gustav, you really living?
But hey, yeah, hold on. Guys.
I'm coming back with a bottle. Hang on.
Okay. And I in like as plain as possible Reichspiel start writing down like and drawing a very crude map of what the actual idea is where I'm trying to get evidence for Dunkmar that like I know who's in charge of this or who at least is telling them what to do. Like telling Gustav and Johannes what to do. But also keeping me in good graces to where Dunkmar doesn't drown me in the river. It's like, hey, I found evidence, and he's going to probably act against them in some way. Mm. Yeah.
Hopefully we don't get caught in the crossfire. We found quite a bit of information, some leads on... where people might be getting some of this stuff from other than Dankmar.
Like other suppliers or dealers?
Yeah, well, just another, you know, so Dankmar's using it for his purposes, but, you know, we went to this murder house and...
sounds fun.
Yeah, it's... Yeah, you should try it sometime.
Yeah, murder house.
sort of like a butcher shop, but
it's all frat house.
Yeah.
I remember Animal House. Yeah, Animal House, Murder House.
Hmm. So we found out that this guy who went berserk and you know murdered his family essentially. That he was a student at the University of Altdorf and might have been involved in something. We got these tickets to go to this...
Sounds like one of those shitty two-penny plays.
Yeah, go to this club. Go raving. By the way, is there a date for... I forgot what the... If we established that there was a date for the tickets to be used, or is it just like... You know, this admits
you gotta get a date. Just take Marla.
No, I mean, is there a special occasion that we need to show up for? Or
yeah,
can we
the
show
date
up any time?
Marla.
I'm
sorry.
At this moment, Gustav returns with a bottle of wine. Gustav, you were given the bottle when you asked. You know, one of the bartenders, like without the word, the kid just handed you a bottle, no fee, because you know. You have this agreement with Neron, he just nodded. Yes, he just nodded at you, and that's that.
And nod back.
Yeah.
And, yeah. Four glasses.
Yeah, grab four glasses. You grab four glasses. So actually, probably just you know four wooden cups, more like. And returned. No, you've entered the room just when the guys, I mean, just when Johannes was showing, I guess, Lambert, the invitations, they don't have a specific date, Johannes. They're just essentially access, you know, access invitations to the Golden Triangle.
They're like the hand stamp.
Yeah, yeah, something like that.
It's
yeah.
a blacklight hand stamp.
Yeah.
Oh boy, they can tell my age.
I pour my glass to the brim.
Was it like a dry bar, one of the kid teen bars, or what the fuck it was?
Yeah.
The stupidest thing I ever heard of.
Yeah. Fuck you, kid.
Sorry.
No worries. Okay, so.
Well, regular clothes. We just did that. We just drank, you know, a bunch of beer outside, and then went in.
Yeah.
Your drinks are too expensive here.
We'll be in the parking lot for half an hour.
The so-called before, yes.
Pregame.
Yeah, pregame. Yeah, that's what we call it in Poland. Like, you do it before you enter the club because it's cheaper. Anyway, Gustav, you see that Johannes is showing Lambert the invitations to the Golden Triangle, and you guys see that Gustav enters with a big bottle of wine and four wooden cups. Yep.
I set the cups down and I pour mine to the brim, and I just sit down and I hold my temples like I have a headache.
Look at him. Honestly,
did you tell him about the Inquisitor?
The what?
Yeah.
Did y'all fuck with a Templar?
I wouldn't say fuck with. We assisted the Templar in his investigations and gave him most of the information that we.
Well, that's good.
that we uncovered.
But he knows we didn't give him all of the information.
Well, that's not good.
Well, we just didn't tell him about the noble lady chick. I think. Or no, we didn't tell him about the university thing either. Oh, well. Okay, we didn't tell him about a lot of stuff, but, you know. We did tell him about the tattoo.
Well, and he pretended to not know.
Well, I think you told him because he told you about what the tattoo means, right? The sun?
It was a symbol of...
Yeah, the tattoo, yeah. But everything else, he knew we weren't telling him, and he pretended to not know that. Which concerns me.
I don't know.
That's not great.
It's fine.
Templars aren't that big of a threat. That's all right.
I guess I'm saying is...
It's not like they're well known for jumping to conclusions.
We're being watched from all sides, and we need to be careful how big we weave this web.
All right, so tread lightly. Got it.
Oh.
Well, in that case, I can fill you in on the rest here, bud. I know you ran away for a minute to go get some booze. And that's fine. I understand. Thank you for the wine. It tastes like paint thinner, but all right. So I had originally wanted to steal some of Herr Koenig's stationery or some missive that he might have sent to... forge documents in his handwriting to insinuate to Dunkmar that he was the puppeteer behind you two dealing Crimson Shade off of his back. I suck at that, so I was unable to secure any of that. So instead, I just went up to his front door, yelled at his bodyguard until I got let in. Got threatened a lot, which, happening in the Empire, that's how that works. And then insinuated that the sheep's head or whatever the fuck we brought over to put on his dining room table was brought by us, but under the orders of the Syndicate, acting on behalf of, or sorry, under the orders of Dunkmar, who had
Syndicate?
Hired
what Syndicate?
Who had hired us.
The Union.
Who had hired us.
I put my head back in my hands.
Who had hired us as we were working for the Union at the time. That is where we're at. I'm pretty sure that I have incited a gang war. However, I've been guaranteed that the only thing he is going to attack, really, is Dunkmar's illegal business. Do I have anything to assure that guarantee? No. So I'm still going to try and find a way to get my my family out of the city. Mm. Because I know you guys probably like Altdorf and that's cool and stuff, but this city is a shithole and I want you all to know it.
Well, I feel like you do not understand human culture, and that's okay. You know, you like living in a hole in the ground with a pie in your face. That's fine.
Yeah, it's safe. There's no fucking Templars. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't see what the issue here is.
Yeah, it's okay. You can let us keep you safe from the powers of evil while you you know, make a pie or whatever it is you do.
I would like to make a check.
Four?
I'm checking if I have the skill. If I don't, it's fine. So
fuck you, skill.
I have to ask. In halfling society, Mike, how common is the knowledge that, you know, we occasionally deal with the dead coming back?
In the Moot, pretty common because it's right next to Suvenia. In the, for example, Outdoors or Noun.
I'm from the Moot, is what I'm saying.
You are from the Moot?
Yeah.
So I can.
in my lore, like in my backstory, is I have traveled to Altdorf to advance halfling rights among the disparaged halflings.
Let's say that you know.
All right.
Without any problems.
I'm sorry. Keeping evil at bay. How has that worked out for your empire with the vampire war?
I'm gonna roll a common knowledge empire.
Mm-hmm. You want to?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
You want to reroll that?
Shut up.
No, not at all. Okay. Like, there's no such thing as. Well, I do know there's undead, but I've never. Vampires are a myth, even though I believe in them wholeheartedly.
No, that's all right. I like that. I like that. I like where that ended.
Necromancers are real, but vampires are
not. I disagree with you wholeheartedly just because I don't like you.
Yeah. I am a good citizen of the Empire, Karl Franz Sigmar.
That's okay. I mean, it's all right, man. We disagree all the time, but we stay together because the sex is fantastic.
I hate to burst your bubble, but I have a vested interest in staying in Altdorf and establishing our trading empire.
I have no idea what the fuck you're talking about.
We can't leave Altdorf.
Why not?
Well, we can leave if we go on a merchant trip,
like a vacation.
Oh, like a
we have reputations here that we're trying to build.
Yeah.
I'm not impressed. That's pretty big reputation, right?
What are you in this for, exactly?
What am I in this for?
Well,
stopping you people from shitting on halflings for the entirety of our fucking
No,
existence.
Really, really. I mean, what's the...
Okay. My end goal here? Like all over, or what we're dealing with right now?
What we're doing right now, what's your end goal?
My end goal is to get Dunkmar either dead or ousted to where he doesn't have to, where he's not dealing Crimson Shade and involving the rest of the family. I don't give a shit. If there's one bad leaf on a tree, you should cut the fucking leaf off. I don't give a shit. Like, if I have one nephew.
I prefer ousted.
Has fucking murdered somebody. Well, congratulations, right. Bud. You're on your own. You went a little bit too far, but if you just steal some shit, I don't give a shit. I would also like to make money on this somehow.
That's part of my concern right there.
Well, preferably not through the sale of drugs, because that's a just a deplorable business.
Well, no, there's nothing wrong with what you're saying, but I don't think you give I don't think you honor the right gods the right way for what you're doing. And I think that's dangerous.
I have to admit, I have no idea what the fuck you're talking about.
At this moment, Marla...
Any money you make is borrowed.
At this moment, Marla enters the
room. I didn't hear anything he just said. What was that?
Yeah, sorry. Just quick for me. At this very moment, Marla enters the room with... holding, rather impressively, 4 plates full of food. And saying cheerfully, "Food is here!" Now, please return.
Your uncle is in this position he's in because he's forgotten the rules to this.
That's what you're saying? He's forgotten his gods?
I have no idea what that is, but yeah.
Fuck, do I have cool-headed?
Do unto others before you're done unto.
Oh, yeah, I do have cool-headed. I'm not gonna freak out over this.
I mean, it's up to you, Michael. You can, you can get pissed off if you think that your character would be pissed off.
Not over something like a difference in religion. Human gods.
I'm trying to convert you because I have real concerns here. You could anger the gods with what you're doing.
Back in character. What I'm doing is trying to betray my uncle, who has already betrayed the family, so that he gets justice served to him. What part of that pisses off any god in the pantheon?
You don't have to kill him.
I'm not going to kill him. I don't do that. No, I'm saying if he gets justice served to him, I don't really give a shit. I just don't want him dragging the family into it. There's no god in any of the pantheons here that, well, maybe some elf god, but, like, there's no god in any of the pantheons here. All the human gods are petty as shit. All the halfling gods.
Hey, says Marla.
Yeah, okay, hey, listen. I've let you guys talk a lot of shit about Sigmar and whatever, but you guys gotta cut it out, especially in polite company.
Alright.
So if you're worried about this witch hunter... You better watch your tongue, because you never know where he's going to be. And if you say that shit in front of him, we might have a bigger problem.
You're talking to Lambert, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, I'm also talking to you, because you have a problem with talking shit about Sigmar, foreigner.
It's friendly. When Sigmar calls, I'll come.
All right.
I mean, boys.
Continue.
We are all Imperials here. Let's just relax, says Marla. There's no need. We all play in the same team, right? That's the saying? Like, same team?
Yes.
Well, I'm not an Imperial, but yeah.
Well,
we're all part of the same continent.
From what I understand, Marienburg was once part of the Empire. Maybe it's just a load of bullshit, but I've heard it from a sailor who was doing me once. And yeah, he said that, you know.
Their destinies are intertwined.
Yeah. But what was that about killing? she asks, looking rather nervous when she asks that. Because
I think Lambert used an analogy that could be interpreted as killing.
Anna what? What's
anal orgy?
No, that's extra. I mean, you have to pay extra for that.
No, it's all about the study.
Oh, all right.
I got it. Nobody else.
Oh, I got it. Yeah. So, all I'm saying is that Lambert used a turn of phrase, which could be interpreted by some as meaning that he wished his uncle dead. And he didn't exactly say that. He just wants him essentially out of the picture, shunned, not doing what he's doing. Not necessarily dead.
Oh.
That's just maybe... Death may be a byproduct, but that's not his goal.
But we are not involved in the byproduct, right? We are not going to... byproduct him.
No.
All right.
That just, if he winds up dead, it'll suck, but I'm not gonna. It's his own damn fault.
Well, he did slap you.
What?
Oh, I mean, yeah.
Oh, that's why you have such a foul mood. Oh. Here.
I thought that was his normal mood.
This is the largest portion, and she, you know, she shoves the largest portion of food towards you, Lambert.
Hell yeah. So I'm going to retrieve from my pack something I've had in there from the beginning of this game that I haven't bothered with.
Loaded pistol.
Is it a pie? It's a bottle.
Ooh.
Of Brandy Brook, you know, one of the cities in the mood. Brandy Brook Port.
Okay.
And I'm going to pour four glasses. And I'm just gonna say,
I'm still nursing my first one.
Well, you're gonna swallow this in one gulp, and you're gonna do it, and you're gonna be happy about it, or else we're gonna have words again, and I'd rather not, because we've had a lot of words, and we've all said things that we all disagree with, but we've been through a lot of shit together. And I just want to say that while I do not agree with everything that has been said, I do agree that perhaps I have been barking up the wrong tree with the actions that I have taken. And that the actions going forward that I will take, perhaps I should look into some other power that can have my back. Because as much as I love, as much as I respect Quinsbury and all that they've done, they haven't really done shit for me.
I'm gonna hold a empty cup out for him to fill with the brandy, and as I'm holding the cup, I have crossed fingers, index finger and middle finger
up to the absolute brim.
I thought it's brandy. I thought it was port. Did I miss port?
Oh, he said brandy something port.
Brandy Brook Port.
Oh,
Blackberry Port.
So it's port from the city called or town called Brandy Brook.
Brandy
okay,
Brook.
Gotcha. Mm-hmm. Right, so you pour everyone a rather generous amount. You all make a toast with this probably very good port. Right, Lambert? This is the good stuff, right?
This is the good shit.
Yeah, so, you know, this is much better than the wine that you...
this is like, if shit goes as bad as it possibly can, this was going to be my nest egg to get enough money to leave the city.
Ooh, nice. It reminds me of
I'm making a statement here of like, hey, this is my last leg. We're in the shit. I need somebody to back me up on this.
Okay. This reminds me of the Albionian whiskey brand. Remember?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
We got carried around for a long time.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. You all, Johannes. I presume that you as well.
Of course.
Take a big swig, and this is the good stuff. Marla coughs slightly in her hand. It's like, you know, this is a large portion of alcohol after all. I mean, right after
the
wine.
Yeah, but it's port, so it's pretty sweet and smooth.
Yeah. She looks at you, Gustav. Gustav, I mean, what were you saying earlier about not leaving Aldorf?
Well, why? this is your home. I mean,
my home. This is. I like the city, but home is where the heart is, right? And all that jazz. Sorry, and all that stuff. Not jazz. Jesus Christ. And all that stuff. if we think that situation here is getting too hectic for us, I mean, I'm not going to lie, this Templar today terrified me, and the way he looked at us, like, it was like he was peering into our souls, and the men that he had with him, like, those, they didn't look like thugs, they looked like mercenaries, and very capable mercenaries at that. Out of all the people, I think only that bastard Hebert was scarier than him, and only because he was and she, you know, whispers, a dark wizard, right? Now Lambert is involved with his uncle, who, I'm sorry Lambert, I'm sorry to say that, don't take this the wrong turn, but sounds like he's a right bastard.
Yep.
And also this Gaston fellow who's involved in some kind of secret society in the university. I don't know, maybe... You still have contacts in Marienburg?
I mean, I know neighborhoods, I know the old neighbors and stuff. I don't know... Contacts is kind of a... vague word.
Wait a minute, I thought last time you and I were on the same page, Marla, that this is our home and we're going to make these other people.
Yes, but last time we didn't meet a crazy witch hunter, and I'm really afraid who are we going to meet next?
Don't fear the witch hunter, I think.
Oh, come on!
Maybe don't fear the reaper.
No.
Need more cowbell.
We're actually on the same side. His methods are extreme, but I mean, for what we're doing...
You think we are on the same side. If he thinks, even for a second, that we are somehow involved, you know, in all of this as potential culprits, he will kill us. And, I mean, and from what I heard, the witch hunters, they seldom do it quickly, you know?
Which is why I think it's better that we go to him, or one of us anyway.
Right, wait, you now want to go to him... After we just left him, not telling him everything, and
no. What? Yeah, no, we're not going back to him right now. We're going to go back to him once we have firmer information, for sure.
Oh, right.
We just didn't. We didn't tell him about
before that.
Yeah.
Yeah, we didn't tell him about our sources. We didn't. It's minor. You know.
Minor, right.
Look, I'd been thinking about it. His reason for being here. I mean, can you imagine if in the Imperial Court, with all the Elector Counts present, if that Crimson Shade were introduced there right after a war, when everybody's owed something? I mean, it would lead to a civil war in the Empire. That's why he's here. Well, like that scene we saw at that house today. I mean, that could happen somewhere in the seat of power.
Aren't you aiming a bit too much? I mean, I'm pretty sure that all Count Franz and his Elector Counts, who, by the way, aren't the Elector Counts, you know, present in their provinces and not here? I don't know.
I'm always saying that because usually, like after wars and stuff, like people are owed shit.
Oh, first of all, you know what I mean? I'm sorry, maybe this is a bit cynical, but I 100% believe that probably people in power... In the Imperial Palace, there are more than a few drug users. I mean, what are you going to do with all that money, right? You either spend it drinking, or whoring yourself to death, or, well, taking drugs.
There's an Elector Count that whores himself out?
I mean, you know what I mean. You visit people like me, right?
I've heard rumors about Nolan as well, but, like, it seems a little touchy.
Well, what I'm saying is that I don't think that... Whoever is behind this Crimson Shade business is aiming that high. He's probably aiming for people like this Gaston, you know, low level, semi-noble. I don't even think that he was a nobleman. I think he was just a rich merchant. But
why else was there a witch hunter there then?
Well, maybe because Schnitzers were connected. Maybe because they are the first family, rich family, who got involved into something like this on this scale. I mean, Gaston killed several of his family members in a very bloody way. We saw Adelgis's body, right? We saw what he did to him. The witch hunter could very well thought that maybe this is, and she once again, you know, lowers her voice, maybe this is some kind of cultish activity or whatever, you know what I mean?
I thought he said as much that he thought it was, but maybe he did not.
Yeah.
Maybe that was our conversation with Finra the other day, now that I think about it.
But you know, let's be honest, your usual outdoorfer right now, if he dies from overdosing this shit, he just dies in the gutter in some back alley and no one cares. I mean, he'll be fodder for the rats and stray dogs. But Schnitzers have money, and money can buy you the attention of the Church of Sigmar or whatever other religious institution employs witch hunters, right? I mean, I would be very surprised if someone from the Emperor's, you know, someone close to the Emperor would overdose on this. Because probably he or she would not be the ideal client of the person or people who are distributing this poison. At least, I don't know, maybe I'm wrong, but it would be bringing too much attention on the sellers, and the sellers, they probably want their operation running smoothly.
Mm-hmm. Well, so that's what we need to do next, is we need to figure out where this Triangle Club is and what's going on at the university, and talk to this Guarina, whatever her name was.
Oh. I think we need to get to her before the Witch Hunter does, because he might know about her too.
Absolutely. No. I think she'll also be able to point us in the direction of the club, because I'm assuming there was something about the tattoos. I thought she was the one that put him up to getting the scorpion tattoo, unless I'm misremembering.
Well, her, the strands from her dress were at the window, were on the window, right? She was the last lover that Gaston received.
The fibers from it.
Yeah.
Lambert burps extremely loudly and says, "All right, I'm lost. What the fuck's going on with this tattoo?"
Oh.
Well, we yeah, think
I told you guys what I did for the last couple of hours. Can y'all fill me in on yours?
I thought we did tell you. I'm sorry, Lambert. No. We were able to find mostly intact pieces of the guy who went berserk, and in examining his remains,
he was in one piece because he died of a heart attack. It was his, I believe, uncle Adelgis that he literally cut to ribbons.
Okay. Yeah. Sorry. I thought he had also taken some sword blows or candelabra blows or something. All right. He died of a heart attack.
Yeah.
Anyway, so he had this tattoo that we noticed that was odd, and we did share that with the Witch Hunter. So it's a scorpion in a rising sun or something like that.
Pretty badass.
Yeah, it does sound cool.
Verily early 90s.
Yeah. In a tribal style.
Oh no, the worst kind.
I have a funny anecdote to say before we continue.
Sure.
On you mentioning tribal. A friend I had at the time, this was probably about 15 years ago, had served like 3 tours in Iraq as a fire support. Yeah. And do you know what they call fire support in the army?
No.
Well, they call them a fister.
Okay. Oh.
And he had fister tattooed really big on his right arm.
Nice.
Which, not smart. Not a great thing to have. He got it covered up with just the ugliest fucking tribal I've ever seen. And it was like really the only option aside from like just tattooing that portion of his arm black. Like, I would have been more okay with you just putting a censorship bar over it.
Yeah. Big black. Well, you could do the like the total blackout. Just get your forearm totally covered in black.
Oh, ooh. Guys, you don't understand. I'm just really into fisting.
Yeah. It reminds me of those people who tattoo some Asian symbols on them, and you know they think that they're all
rice.
Yeah, they're all deep and shit, and it turns out that's just rice with fried chicken, something like that.
I told my wife, I was like, "Hey, honey, if I get a tattoo of some Chinese symbols, and I get just a tattoo of like my favorite thing I order off of the local Chinese restaurant, you think that'd be cool?" Said, "No, my parents would probably laugh about it." I was like, "I wouldn't. It's my favorite thing to order from that restaurant."
Oh boy!
I met a guy
human
once.
Beef? Hell yeah!
I met a guy who was into the the Shirinji Kempo, the Shaolin inspired karate.
Oh, good.
And he had a massive tattoo of Chuen Fa on his chest. The only problem was that apparently they didn't mirror it. So when the guy put the template on his chest, it's backwards. So in the mirror,
he's like an ambulance in a mist.
Yeah. It's like this massive fucking chest tattoo. I was like, make sure you do your research before you get massive Chinese characters free, tattooed free on your commit. Body.
Yeah.
Just one last thing before we return. I mean, it wasn't Polish, but there's this Facebook group, called The Worst Tattoo, something like that. And and there was this couple, and they've tattooed matching sentences right above their crotches. The guy had, my huge dick belongs only to my, Anna or something like this. Mm-hmm. And she had a similar thing, but with, Marius or whatever. And later it turns out that they've split. the guy. But
that's why you never get a name.
Yeah.
You can get mom or something, but you never get a name.
Yeah. Well, I saw one recently where a chick had her boyfriend's name tattooed completely covering her fucking forehead.
Jesus Christ.
Kevin. And fucking four-inch letters across.
Well,
fucking
you've really bottlenecked yourself into the only guy you can ever date. It has to be named Kevin.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's horrible. Oh, anyway, later the guy with the crotch tattoo. I think he when they split it, he just blacked out the name, but not the rest. So so it was really weird. My huge dick belongs only to.
Redacted.
Yeah, redacted, exactly. From some fucking Dota Green or something. Oh, by the way, we were 10 and
just
I just
put a line and say your name here.
what the servant told you, by the way, is that he was studying geography, Gaston, and 1 month ago, he was invited to the club called Red Dragon. It was it's supposedly on the grounds of the university itself, and it's run by the Guild of Explorers. And the letters were to 8 different women, some of them foreign, and of course they were more explicit, pornographic than romantic. But also, the invitation to the Golden Triangle is something completely different. Anyway, now we can return.
Actually, I need to take a quick break for the bathroom.
Sure.
If that's okay.
No worries. Right. 5 minute break, and we'll be right back.
Yeah.
Cool.
I might actually head out to get some turkey.
Hello?
Hey.
Hello?
Hello?
Oh, that was weird.
Can you? Oh, okay.
Okay. Oh,
I'm here.
I got a big ass plate of food.
Nice.
I made some. Nice. I'm eating cereal, so I'm keeping it muted.
Oh, I haven't eaten since 6 o'clock yesterday. I'm okay. Gonna keep that trend going.
Okay, let's return to the discussion. I've just told you about out of game, about the club, so you know the full picture. I don't remember who was speaking, Johannes or Gustav, but anyway, onto you guys.
So, I mean, you guys know the plan I have is to incite a gang war. You got anything better?
Well, so that handles the.
That hand is already on the table. There's no walking this one back.
Right. No, I understand. So that handles the Dankmar piece of the equation.
Hopefully.
So to speak, that he'll be busy with that, so he won't have time to try to kill us.
Yeah,
I think is what you know how I see your overall plan. But it doesn't. We still need to figure out where these drugs are coming from, and if someone has some ulterior motives other than making money, which we suspect. Then we need to follow these angles that we got from the Schnitzer house, and I think first thing is tracking down this Guarina Farina. I don't remember what her last
name. You suspect the Church of Mermidia?
Her name was. Let me quickly see this. Find this.
Or maybe the target is. Believers of Mermidia. I don't know. Some guy with Mermidia tattoo.
Yes. Well, we're suspecting some kind of cult. And
Guarina
so,
Akner. Guarina Akner. I'm going to write this down.
Yeah, I think you did write it down before, but I got it.
Here.
Yep. I just couldn't remember her name right now, and I didn't want to look. yes, I think this Guarina Akner is our best lead. So we need to track her down. I forget what time of day it is. I think it's evening now, right? So
no, it's late afternoon. I think it's late afternoon.
Oh, late afternoon.
Yeah. Oh. Oh, no, it's not evening yet.
Okay.
Just remember that, when you're traveling... Sorry, in a second, Sean, that when you're traveling over Altdorf, it usually takes a lot of time. This is a huge city. And I know that this map probably doesn't have the right scale, but really the city and the fact that the streets are changing, the fact that there are so many people on the streets because of the war, is just a slog to walk through and to get almost anywhere. Sean, back to you. Sorry.
Okay. Well. So we have these various leads about. The Explorers Club, the Red Dragon Club, the Golden Triangle, which we don't know where the fuck that is, but I think the first person that we really should focus on is this Guarina Akner, and. She seems to be the last person that saw him alive before this party.
I agree.
Or dinner or whatever.
Do we know where she is, or we just have the name?
We haven't addressed
him a letter, right?
You know.
Oh yeah.
You know that she lives. She's from somewhere to the south, but staying nearby. She's from the south of the empire, but she stays in Aldorf, essentially. Mm. The Club of Explorers was the Red Dragon. It was the club of the Guild of Explorers. And the Golden Triangle, you don't know what kind of club this is. You only have 4 invitations, probably for Gaston and, you know, his friends or maybe girlfriends. You're not sure. Mm-hmm. But, you know, you don't know where Guarina lives. You can, of course, ask about her on the street.
Yeah. Well, we will ask about the Ackner household in... We have these letters to deliver.
I think we should go to the College of Altdorf tomorrow and follow up some of these leads.
Oh, absolutely. We have the professor's name too, although I think we might want to keep him out of it if we can. But yeah, find the explorer. So you said the Explorers Guild?
Guild of Explorers. Okay. This is apparently, from what you understand, this is a sort of organization that has its headquarters in the Aldorf University, and Gaston was either, you know, part of it, or he wanted to become part of it. You're not really sure. It's probably, you know, of course, for... I mean, he was studying geography, so... yeah. Okay. But other than that, you don't know. You can, Sean, if your character has some kind of academic knowledge, you know, maybe you can roll on it if you have it.
So what? I have academic knowledge science.
That wouldn't... in that case, you can roll common knowledge empire, but with minus, I would say, given your expertise, minus 20% would be fair. Because you have really almost no idea about this. No.
You guys have any idea what this Explorers Guild is? Do you know anything about this stuff?
Let's see here.
I don't know unless it's something I could roll for.
I don't think, Gustav, that you'll be able to roll for anything. You're not from here.
Yeah, I don't think genealogy or the moot is going to do anything for me.
No, and I don't think that you have, you know, any geography-related skills or backgrounds, honestly.
Nope.
Actually, you know what, Gustav, roll me minus 30% common knowledge wasteland. If you want. Okay. No. No.
At least it's not a botch.
No, that's not a botch. I mean, even if you botched, it wouldn't matter in this case. Right, so no, you have no idea about, you know, how this guild is structured, how it works, stuff like that. You don't even really know where the University of Aldorf is located, honestly, because you've never been there, unless I'm mistaken, and Johannes, you actually studied there. In that case, I'm sorry, of course, you know where it is, but I don't know.
Would I get my
Aldorf U, go Griffins.
Would I get my physician's medallion there? Is that where I would have gotten it for Reichland?
A medallion, fancy.
But oh no, it's like a license, like the practice.
You think that you'd probably get it in some kind of a city. You know, in a city bureau somewhere like that.
Okay.
Not in the university per se, because it would be given to you by one of the city officials, not necessarily by someone at the university. Sean, you were saying something?
Well, I was just saying that according to my backstory, I am in school in Altdorf. And that's where I met Gustav, and that I'm just speaking for Gustav because I have no idea, but that we were hanging out in the taverns around the medical school.
Mm-hmm.
I thought I met you in Karaburg, but we were drinking a lot then, so who knows?
So there are different tales. I liked it. Maybe you guys were just so, you know, so wasted that you have, yeah, that you have no idea where this happened.
We don't know specifically where the University of Althor is. We've never really been there.
I don't think that you were there.
Would Marla know?
Oh, I can roll for her, but you know this is not exactly her specialty, so I will give her -20% as well. No, she has no idea. She just, you know, shakes her head and says with this rather mischievous smile.
You don't go to school to become a whore.
No, Lambert. What I want to say is that the students usually can't afford my services.
That too.
Yes, that too. Thank you. No, I have no idea where the university is located. We would probably have to ask around town.
Maybe Finron knows where it is.
Finron seems to know almost everything, so yeah, that makes sense.
Safe bet.
I think we should take watches tonight.
Well, it's still the afternoon. I think we should go look for this Ackner household. And then take watches tonight.
It was early evening when I was at Air Conings.
Mm. Oh, was it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so yeah, that's I mean, all right. 2 weeks, 2 week break usually just messes with my with my timeline, timetable. Yeah, so let's just say true that right now it's probably like just evening, maybe not late evening, but you know. 8 p.m. stuff like that. 9 p.m.
All right. Well, then let's take watches and go to sleep. And I don't think anything will happen to us in here though, because Finron is watching out for us. But I still think it's a good. I think you're right. We should keep watches anyway.
Yeah. And I mean, do we? I guess, says Marla, that you know, walking during the night on the streets will probably be much more dangerous to us right now, given how many people, organizations, you know, factions want us, well, are interested in us, right?
I think we should conduct our business mostly in the daytime.
Yeah, yeah.
Be honest.
Marla, I think you should stick with Lambert, because he at least has the protection of being Dankmar's nephew. Johan and I are kind of marked men at the moment.
Well, I mean, with all due respect, I don't want any kind of protection from Dankmar. Not from someone who...
I mean, it's nice of you to say no protection from me. I get it, but yeah.
Well,
yeah.
I thought, correct me if I'm wrong, Lambert, but I thought part of your whole idea was that getting Marla a job and whatnot at the inn, the intention was to have her stay at the inn and be protected.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's another thing that I'm going to work here, right? So yeah. Yep. Tomorrow you boys will probably be mostly on your own. Right? Or
yes.
Or am I working but not really working, because you know she has
no. Finron's paying you.
Yeah, but he's paying me for something.
Well, and also
but keep
yes.
an eye for anybody that comes looking for us.
Right. We want you to be protected. We want to, you know. Oh. We don't want to risk your health and safety.
That's sweet of you, really. And yes, I am going to at least earn a few coins here. They may come in handy soon.
Yeah. I mean, Marla, you're capable by yourself. We remember, yeah. But
when you say that, yeah. You see that her face darkens a bit as she remembers what she did at the Staller's estate, you know, outside of town. But she just nods. She doesn't say anything.
Nope.
She just
triggering
nods.
Triggering her PTSD.
Yeah, PTSD.
Yeah. She says... I think that you should probably stick together from, you know, tomorrow until we see this through. Lambert, you're saying that you're right now safe from your uncle. That's very fine, and all. But you know, when the gang war starts, right, his opponents might want to target you. And if you're going to be alone on the street, well, you know what I mean.
Carry the biscuit. I got it.
Yeah.
Risk it for the biscuit.
Yeah. Gustav, Johannes?
Yes?
I'm sure that you take good care of him, right?
Of course. He's our little buddy.
Yeah. Oh, and Gustav...
You know I'm like perfect dick height to just make you regret that whole thing.
Well. Gustav, she looks at you.
Lambert dick biter.
Brian?
Yeah, I'm here.
She, you know, she looks at you and she says, can you, just in case, check the price for getting to Marienburg? By, of course, by the river. I'm not saying I'm just saying that we might have to.
I'll look into it.
I hope that we won't have to, and she looks at you, Johannes. Because this is a city of opportunity, but you know how this works, right?
Well, yeah, you have to be alive in order to do your business.
To benefit from the opportunities, right. Mm-hmm. Now, wake me up when it's my time to take the watch, she says. And she just goes to bed immediately. And starts snoring very very fast.
I envy her.
You guys do
any... It's all those tours, man. She's able to sleep everywhere.
I mean, all of you actually feel rather sleepy after, you know, you all of you got this wonderful meal brought to you from downstairs. Blood sausages and pickled cabbage, as well as braised pork legs and sweet mustard. Then you've also drank the wine that Gustav brought. Then you drank the port that, you know, that Lambert took from his backpack. So we are all pretty sleepy. Who's taking the first watch?
I'll take the first watch. I'm gonna work in my journal.
Mm-hmm.
And try and come up with ideas to counteract the effects of the Crimson Shade.
Oh, okay, nice.
So I don't know anything about chemistry in real life, so I do equations and stuff. And
okay.
You're pretty close.
Asian of the moon.
I don't know anything about chemistry, but they trust me to work on it.
Synthesize things.
Who's taking the second watch?
I'll take second.
So, Johannes, you take the third, or you...
Yeah, I'll take third.
Okay, so Marla takes the last watch, and then she goes immediately to work. All right. You go to sleep, except for you, Gustav. You're just, you know, staying up late at your table. Outside, of course, it's already dark, but outdoor thrives during the night, especially in this place. You know, you hear the... hundreds, if not thousands, of people just having a grand time nearby, drinking, yelling, you know, singing. You hear, of course, occasional sounds of violence, of people brawling in the streets and yelling at each other. The nights are mercifully much less humid and hot than the days right now, but even so, you just, you know, the amount of the amount of flies pestering all of you, and you know the fact that you are constantly just sweating, your hair is just, you know, greased, even though you took a bath, I believe today or yesterday, it's already, you know, it's already been forgotten. You're just like the myriad people of the Empire's capital, dirty, sweaty. You know, smelling of alcohol and onions and you know, whatever they ate.
That's perceived.
Yeah.
The chemical in onions that gives it that smell. on your skin, or it's the chemical in your body that's released when you when onions touch your skin.
Okay, that's good to know. Thank you. I thought it's cool. I thought that it was like some kind of juice or something like that.
It's a chemical reaction between the oils of your skin and the enzymes in your body and the oils from the onion.
Gotcha. Okay, that's good to know. And yeah, you're just sitting at the table, probably drinking the last of the wine, sporadically, just to do something. You're trying to think about how to counter the Crimson Shade. You know, how is it possible to fight this kind of poison? I mean, the most horrifying thing, of course, is that this is a completely natural thing. Crimson Shade supposedly is made from the leaves of the Estalian red oak. At least that's what you've gathered, that's what you've heard. But this is not some man-made poison. Well, I mean, it's made by men, but it's created by nature. And really, you you have no idea how you would do this unless there would be some kind of a grand social campaign against drugs. You know. Like war on drugs. Huh?
Oh boy. are we starting Dare?
Starting hugs not
hugs
trying
and
to
drugs,
build up
exactly.
I'm trying to build up to learning prepare poison because it's something I could learn under this career. So yeah.
You know the slogan Sigmar was in juicing.
Yeah, there you go.
And he was still ripped.
This is your mind on drug bash.
This is your mind on drugs after Galmaras hit it. And as you were thinking about this, you didn't even like notice when the time was up for Lambert to switch with you. So you woke him up, Lambert. You probably took Gustav's place at the table, right? Mm-hmm. And you're practicing your calligraphy, I presume.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and that's you have, of course, you have this like small candle stand in your room, because remember the Shepherd's Wand is a nice looking place, but it's by no means a fancy place. It's very clean and very ordained. Orderly. Because Finrod just takes care of it, but you don't have, for example, a fireplace in your room. You don't have a lamp in your room, stuff like that. But you have a candle stand, and you just practice your calligraphy right next to it.
Mm-hmm.
Probably thinking also how to deal with this whole Dankmar business. I mean, you'd probably never think that your uncle would stoop to such low standards as to deal drugs, as to dispose
honestly,
of bodies, stuff
I'm
like that.
I'm trying my best to recall any features about the black hooded person that was talking to him.
You remember that he was tall or she was tall, because you're not even sure about the sex. That the person had a long dark cloak with a hood. The cloak was of a, it was of a rather high quality. It wasn't ragged at the edges, it wasn't patched or covered by mud. It was actually very clean, and the material was fine. It had this slightly glossy feel to it when the pale light came through the dirty windows of the room. It reflected from the material in a rather strange way. The person was also very moved very fluidly, almost like he or she was maybe not dancing, but just moving, almost like he or she was levitating slightly above ground. Of course, it wasn't the case. You were 100% sure that their feet were touching the ground. But the slenderness, the grace, it was there.
Ah.
but you don't remember anything about the face. You don't remember anything about the hands.
Out of game.
Yeah?
Out of game. Can't tell if it's man or woman. Moves super gracefully. Has nice stuff. Probably an elf.
Well.
I wasn't there, but...
Or a Slaaneshi cultist.
So an elf.
Yeah, of course, because they're all Slaaneshi cultists. Yeah. And I mean, you didn't saw any weapons, you know, nothing like that. But definitely, the person, you know, now that you think of it, this person gives you the creeps. Even thinking about the encounter sends shivers down your spine. And you know, before you even notice it, it's Johannes' turn to switch with you. So you wake him up and you go back to sleep. You know, even despite the humidity in the air, the sounds from the outside, all of you, rather, all of you have zero problems. None of you have any problems with going to sleep because you're exhausted mentally. Like, this whole deal with the shade and before with the necromancer, it's just a rush. And Aldorf really is a place that it can really suck the life out of you, like, you know, the energy out of you with this, with its constant pace, with the crowds, with it being overcrowded right now. Even Marienburg doesn't have an atmosphere like that, Gustav, and, you know, this constant rush of people, it can be exhausting. Johannes, you take your place at the table. What are you doing with your time before you wake up Marla?
Well, I'm going to play around with my new writing kit.
Mm-hmm. Sure, yeah. Nice.
And I'm sort of just jotting down sort of like my to-do list / my goals for, you know, it's like, well, I gotta meet with Herr Stoller again and see if he'll give me entree into the Merchant's Guild. I gotta go meet Hannah again and
try to get into her pants. we know.
Into her skirts.
I mean, socialize with her, of course.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes. What goods could we possibly start trading in that would make us the most money? And should we go to the Kislev corridor or that seems like a little outside of our venue right now, but I have been looking at the trade rules and various information about how trade works in the Empire, so I'm trying to put together like a cheat sheet for that.
Oh, that's very cool. Okay.
Yeah. Will we ever get there? I don't know.
Sure.
So essentially, I'm daydreaming, trying to make a, you know, I need to do this, and this.
Mm-hmm.
I need to buy my ledger for the company. I need to, you know,
create a logo. You know,
yes.
For your startup. Yes.
I think there must be a fist involved somewhere.
Of course. Right. I mean, you know, daydreaming. You probably have some solid ideas about your future, and definitely Aldorf is it is a place of great opportunities, of many great opportunities. But again, you also feel the same what your comrades are feeling, even though, you know, you don't know that. That this place can be really, really tiring, exhausting almost. Still, you are pretty sure that even in cities like Ubersrake or, you know, or Karaberg, you wouldn't have that many options, that many possibilities. So perhaps it's, you know, it's good to suffer those less than desirable you know, parts of life in Altdorf, but also follow your dreams and accomplish them, right? Make them a reality.
Make your dreams come true.
Exactly. and so after you know, your few hours of watch, you wake up Marla. She groggily, you know, gets out of bed, and spends the rest of her shift just preparing for the hard day of work in the inn, at the inn. And outside, the first rays of the sun are already, you know, emerging above the cityscape. You guys, when you wake up, actually, Gustav, you're being woken up by Marla, you know, a few hours ago. She whispers to your ear, I need to go to work. You be careful, right?
You too.
Yeah. She,
again, the cats.
Yeah. She kisses you back. She, you know, takes the empty bottles and cups and just leaves the room. It's already light outside, of course. The sky is clear. It's not yet. It's not very hot yet. The birds, the dogs mostly, let you know that this is a brand new day. But also a few roosters that people keep in their, you know, little home-like gardens or chicken coops behind their houses. They also, of course, start the cuckoo, you know, sound.
I'm gonna grab a shave.
Yeah. Okay. I'll grab a shave. Sure. All of you get up. You have a shaving kit, by the way. You have it.
Oh, at barber surgeon tools.
Oh yeah. Nice. All right. So you grab a quick shave, probably dry shave. Although you do have a pitcher of water, almost, you know, all of you make sure that it's always full, because right now night without water would be a torture. So Gustav, you use the mirror hanging on the wall, you know, to just get a quick shave. Johannes, Lambert, you guys get up.
I don't even know what we're doing today. That's how fucking tired I am. I go downstairs. I just leave the room. I go downstairs to get Finron to give me coffee or some shit.
Well, coffee is. This is not a place for coffee. Like, coffee in the old world is a luxury. Like, really.
That's fair.
You pay 50 gold crowns for a kilo. I remember that distinctly.
All right. Well, then give me a fucking bump of cocaine. That's probably cheaper.
We got plenty of crimson shade. No.
yeah, you guys have crimson shade.
Actually, we don't.
No, you don't. You've given it away, but yeah.
It's... I just come back with a jug of milk.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sharing it. Just drinking a jug of milk.
When you go down stairs, you see that, you know, already quite a few people are inside. Mostly tired workers from nearby warehouses who are just grabbing a quick bite and something to drink before their shift. Marla is already serving them. Finron standing behind the bar and, you know, chatting with one of the locals. He never seems tired, but maybe that's because he's an elf and you probably don't know what tired elf looks like. He just nods at you, and when you approach the bar and tell him that you want a jug of milk, he, you know, without a word, he fetches it for you himself, and then he says that he'll have someone bring breakfast to your room in a few minutes.
Thanks, buddy. We can always count on Finron.
And he's like, "Hey." And winks. No, I'm kidding. He's not saying that, but he just he smiles politely, which honestly for him is more than his usual stony, unemotional self.
Like having an elf boyfriend, it's great.
Yeah, interracial, interracial, nice. Okay, so So you, Johannes and Gustav, you see that Lambert returns with the jug of milk.
Asshole, I'm lactose intolerant.
It's not for you.
You are? Lactose
intolerant? No, I'm kidding.
Okay, I don't know, maybe you are. I mean, you know, people in the Empire probably also have what was the sugar, diabetes, yeah. The things like diabetes or lactose intolerance.
It's probably just the bloody flux. It's okay.
Yeah, everything's good. It's just Nightglitch rot. Oh my god, I'm turning into a plague bearer.
What's that? My son likes that joke where Cartman gives a bad review to some restaurant because they made his poop come out solid, not all watery like he likes.
Oh god.
Oh wow!
I felt like I was getting raped in the ass.
Jesus Christ! Okay.
Yeah, anything to make it less work, I guess.
Gustav and Johannes, you see that Lambert returns with milk, and he just, you know, he already takes big swigs from the jug. What are you guys doing?
Putting on my armor for the day.
Hmm.
And saying, hey, after we have breakfast, we should start asking around for this Ackner family. See maybe if Finron knows anything about them.
Like where the college is.
Yeah, we could ask him that.
The university.
Ask him that too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We could ask him that too. That is a good idea. But I feel like we need to go find this woman first, especially if we're concerned that the witch hunter finds her before we do.
Yeah, that's number one.
I mean, I'm just along for the ride here, guys.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and you need to show me how to use that sling thing.
What? Wait, we never talked about this. What?
Yeah, I want to learn how to use a sling.
All right. Here's how this goes. This is important, and I'm going to try and bullshit him.
Then roll, please.
What is lie? That's going to be.
I'm going to get some breakfast.
It's going to be a charm, isn't it?
Lie.
Yeah, charm is essentially.
All right, time to test out my confidence game. But yeah, it's all like this is a very important halfling weapon. Like this is. Not something I can just teach for free. You're going to have to pay me. And that, you know, we're friends, so I'll lessen that, you know, like 2 silver a day kind of thing for me to show you how to use it. But you're going to have to be responsible for getting your own sling. Before you buy one, though, you should let me inspect it to make sure it's a good one.
What if we gave you a 10% discount at Prestige International?
I'm part of Prestige International.
What if we gave you more shares?
Deal.
Okay, I'll write up the contract as soon as I get a ledger.
Okay, so how the roll was?
That was a 42. I needed under a 55.
Yeah, but remember that this is a counter test. So now
we need him to counter it.
Yeah.
Do I roll willpower or do I roll charm myself?
You roll. Wait, this was a charm. Mm. So I think you roll intelligence, honestly.
Oh, yeah.
No.
Oh, shit.
Haha, get fucked.
You have no reason to doubt him.
2 silver, you say?
And that's a steal.
Mm-hmm. Alright.
Literally.
Yeah, that's true.
All right. Well, I will figure out. And how many days is this going to take now?
How long does it take to? I think he has to roll to see if he retains a skill, right?
No, I mean, when you teach him, yes.
Yeah.
No, I would say that it just
honestly
takes...
like when I learned how to use a sling as a real living person, it took like 2 or 3 days.
Yeah, that's just like a few days. No. And you don't need to roll anything. You just need someone to teach you. So that's it.
And I need a sling.
Yeah, I'll get him.
So first step, buy a sling.
Mm-hmm.
Step two, learn how to use it.
Yeah.
So he'll get the specialist weapon group sling next session if he chooses to buy it.
Yep. For if you have, of course, you can buy it for 100 if you have this in your character advancement section. If you don't, you can buy it for 200.
Okay.
Buying skills and talents from outside your career always costs twice as many points.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. That's the thing.
So that's the thing. So just although it's not beneficial to me, that probably then predicates how long it'll take for me to learn it.
So probably one.
How long it takes me to get 200
XP. Mm-hmm. XP. Yep.
Because I only have 85 right now, so it's possible.
It's possible.
No.
But I haven't been maxing out my XP most sessions, so we'll see what happens.
Yeah. Okay, so go ahead, Gustav.
I was looking at some of the ingredients in Esmeralda's calming nectar. I think they might be able to counteract the effects of Crimson Shade. Do you know anything more about it?
Do I? I don't know what the fuck you're talking about. Never heard of it.
Well, good thing we're going to the university, I guess.
Yeah. Okay, you hear knocking at the door.
Yes.
Mine Evan, you hear a rather high-pitched voice. Your food is here.
Okay, I'll open the door and let whoever in.
Yeah, you open the door and you see a familiar-looking face of one of Finron's, you know, servants. He has holds a large tray with food on it. He actually holds it much less skillful than Marla. He's barely balancing it, and he say compliments from Master Finron. Where can I? Oh, here's the table. Please allow me, he says. He brings food. It's actually a very good meal because all of you got a nice portion of lamb chops with sliced apples, and spice honeyed water to drink. The boy, you know, just bows very, very low after he brought you the good stuff. All of you think that he probably believes that you're very important, given your treatment, and so he also asks, "Can I give you anything else, my sirs?"
And we should tip him.
Okay.
I'll give him a shilling.
You give him a shilling. Well, you give them a boy a shilling. His eyes just go very wide because, you know, that's a lot of money for. He probably has like 15 years. He's probably 15 years old, maybe 14. You're not sure. He of course quickly pockets the silver coin, and you know just beams up. Can I give you anything else, my sirs?
No, that's fine. Thank you very much.
Of course. Thank you. I will later.
I think I'm only like 2 or 3 years older than.
Yeah, you. Probably. I will later collect your dishes. He says, and you know, bowing almost constantly, he moonwalks out from the room, just falls through the balustrade because he wasn't looking where he's going, just breaks his neck. No, I'm just kidding, of course, but you know, he literally walks backwards from your room, closes the door. The food smells very good. The spiced water with honey also smells very good. I guess that you probably eat a very hearty breakfast.
Sounds good.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Do you discuss anything during your meal?
Well, just reiterate the plan of action to find this Guarina Ackner and question her about the about Gaston and if she knows anything about the any of these clubs or anything.
Or there's the Explorers Society.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and
Explorers Guild.
Yeah, and then head over to the university if hopefully if we can get someone to tell us where it is, and maybe on the way buy a sling and some sling bullets.
Right.
Sling bullets.
Oh, isn't that what they're called?
They're called.
But you can use stones, but
you can use stones, but like it's called bullets. Yeah.
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 Really?
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh wow. Okay.
Yeah. But
wow.
They're usually made from lead.
Yeah.
The sling is cool in Warhammer because you don't really need to. I mean, you can find ammunition for it literally on the ground. Right. You can buy it, of course.
Using actual ammunition does confer some bonus, but the finding just stones will give you just regular ass sling.
Yep, exactly. Plus, there's also the bigger version of the sling, the one that you need to place in the ground.
A heavy sling.
Heavy sling, and then you just, you know, use both hands to fire it. But that's the big stuff, right? That's the ballista of slings.
I thought you were talking about the staff sling.
Yeah, that's exactly
that. No, we're talking about like a half inch hot pot thing.
Oh, I thought the staff sling was more like freaking what's that stupid sport? Lacrosse.
I mean, or Hiawai.
No, that's Hiawai,
where you get the stone ball traveling like 130 miles an hour.
That's exactly that staff sling. This is the thing. But of course, before you use it, you need to spend, I believe, an entire turn deploying it, because you need to put it in the. Take it from your back, put it in the ground, load it with the stone, stuff like that. While normal sling, you can use almost immediately without any problems.
Guys, I just had a thought. There could be an occasion where we try to make a halfling hot pot.
Okay. I support that.
The coolest artillery piece ever.
Yeah.
Hey, I was at the Goblin Doom Diver.
Yeah. I don't know if I just forgot to go to the bathroom when we took a break or if I've just been drinking too much beverage, but I need to go to the bathroom again. So
sure.
We'll be right back.
No worries.
I put too much food on my plate.
No worries.
No, I'm all right.
Yeah, it's going pretty well, all things considered. I think.
I'm gonna take 30 gold out of my share in the floorboard to carry with me.
Mm-hmm.
Dude, what the fuck? Where do you guys get all this fucking money?
The magic floorboard.
God.
Yeah, I show you where the floorboard is.
12 crowns.
How do you only have 12 crowns?
Because you guys didn't pay me.
What?
You guys said we're gonna keep the money for safekeeping, and then I never saw that money again. I just never asked about it.
Okay. Out of character, you have a share of money in there that we don't have accounted for. Then we were paid 20 or 25 gold. By the Stallers. I can't remember which it was. I think it might have been like 25 after, because they paid us 10 up front.
Well, I mean, I spent 10 last session on just clothes and stuff. I'll probably spend
another 10. We can figure out how much you have.
On a writing kit.
So tell me.
I think you left early that session.
Or
but,
we already
like,
have
you were
a
giving...
writing kit in the group. I could just use it to buy good paper and binding materials.
So Tommy, are you giving Lambert any money, Gustav?
I don't need any. I've got 12 crowns in my purse. If I carry more, I might get robbed.
Okay. So after finishing your meal, the boy comes by himself, like a few minutes after you finish it, almost like as if he sensed when you are done, and asks if he can take your, if he can take the dishes away.
Yes, thank you.
He once again, you know, bows very low and you know, mumbles some kind of, you know, thanks to you. And then I guess you all walk down the stairs and out onto the Street of 100 Taverns, yes? Or are you asking Finrone?
Yeah. Yeah, I wanted to ask him if he knew anything about the Ackner family and if he knows how to get to the University of Altdorf.
All right. You approach him when you're going downstairs. The place is already filled to the brim. All of you guys see Marla, you know, cruising between the tables with a tray, either full of food or full of drinks. But she, you know, maybe she even notices you, but she's just too busy to talk to you or even to acknowledge you. You approach the bar. Finrone is just cleaning the counter after someone spilled a rather large amount of drink on it. The elf looks slightly irritated, but when he sees you, he you know, puts the towel behind the counter and says, nods at all of you and says, "Greetings, humans, and you, Master Halfling. Your friend is working very well. I am extremely pleased."
"Thanks for taking her on and keeping her safe."
"No worries. Her shift ends today after the fifth afternoon bell. I don't want my employees to be overworked. It's uncalled for. Anyway, can I help you with anything?"
Yes. We had a couple questions. Do you know how to get to the University of Altdorf?"
"Yes, of course. It's actually very, very close to this place. It's slightly north from here. Wait a second. I need to check the name. It is in the Schulevegend district. This is Altdorf's academic district. You can't really miss it. Schuleve. Here. That's what it's called."
"Oh, okay."
"You can't really miss it. The university, of course, is the premier building of this place. So, you know, you probably won't be able to walk past, right past it and not spot it. Mm-hmm. Just a word of advice. I've heard that it is a labyrinthine construct. And it's very easy to get lost there. Just saying."
So sort of like the whole rest of Altdorf. Got it."
"Yes." He says with a slight smile. "Anything else?"
"Have you heard of a family by the name of Ackner?"
"Going to roll for him?" He says, like, Ackner. No, I never heard about her. She's from nobility?"
"We thought so, but maybe not. I thought she was a noble from somewhere to the south that has a family house here."
"Well, I'm sorry to say, but I never heard about her. You just probably need to inquire about this name on town."
"Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're good at that."
"Anyway, I need to go back to work. I wish you fair winds and safe travel." And with that, he nods and you know, and goes to the kitchen. Goes through the door behind him into the kitchen, where he starts.
"May Sigmar guide you."
He just nods when you say that, but you know, he disappears behind the door, and start. You hear that? You hear him talking loudly to probably to his cooks or staff or whatever. So you leave the place, mm-hmm. I presume.
Mm-hmm.
Gustav Lambert, unless you want to do anything else here.
I'll leave with Johannes.
Yeah. Lambert, you too?
Yeah, I'll follow along.
Yeah. You follow along and you go towards the... Well, first of all, sorry. You want first to go to the university, or you want to ask about the girl or the woman, Guerina Akner?
Yeah, so I think I want to find her first. That's my priority. So yeah, I'll ask about her. But I'm thinking that we need to head essentially back towards the Schnitzer house, and that might, you know, in that area is probably where we'll have better luck. But maybe we can find somebody knows on this side of the river.
I feel like somebody at the university would know her. If Gaston mm-hmm. was spending most of his time there.
Yeah, I don't know. I thought time was of the essence. We were worried about the witch hunter finding her.
Right.
That's why I want to find her now.
Yeah, we could try by the Schnitzer estate.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, I'll ask on the street right now. Hey, I've got these letters. Can you tell me, do you know where the Akner household is? Would that be a gossip test?
Yes. If you want to learn about... if you want to find the Akner girl, Green Akner, you need to make gossip tests. And actually, you need to gather 3 successes. You can gather them during one test, of course, mm-hmm. if you are very lucky, or during during a couple tests. That said, given that you are asking about a single person in Aldorf, each test takes an hour. Because you're just walking the streets, asking people, there are no modifiers, bonus or, beneficial or detrimental. That said, of course, you can either, each one of you can ask separately, or you can, one of you can support a person who speaks for a plus 10%, but then all of you are together.
I think we're better off all testing separately.
I think so.
Okay.
And, we're doing it on our way walking towards there, so it'll take us 3 hours to get there.
Yes, just so you know, if you are doing this separately, you are not together. You're not like in the eye distance, eye contact from each other. Realize that. And in this test, botches work. Just so you know.
Okay.
So, are you doing this separately?
Well, now I don't know.
Okay, how about we all stick together, and I'm assuming that Lambert, you have the best fellowship.
Yeah, probably.
You know me, old Lambert.
Big. So okay, we'll help you out with the plus 10%
person.
Yeah. So both Gustav and I will support Lambert in his quest to find Guerina Akner.
Okay. So you go out onto the street of 100 taverns, then you go towards the Schuller again, the university district, and along the way, Lambert, you are with help from your friends, you are asking about Guerina Akner. Fellowship plus 10%.
Oi, 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 oi.
Nice.
Two successes.
You have plus 10%. No, that's only one still.
Oh yeah, you're right.
Yeah, only one. You've passed. Roll second time. Nice, and that's it. You've passed. It took you less than 2 hours, probably an hour and a half. as you are actually entering the Schulergent, you are asking people from this district, you know, about the Ackner family, Gurin Ackner. Sorry, Brian, what was that?
I didn't say anything.
Oh, sorry. So someone was saying something, or?
I didn't hear anybody say anything. I thought I heard
okay.
noise. That was it.
So, first let me quickly describe Schulergent. Altdorf's academic district is an eclectic mixture of classical architecture, timber-framed office buildings, and dilapidated tenements of grey brick. The Altdorf University complex occupies roughly a third of Schulergent. West of the university is the Schlafstadt Quarter, a shabby neighborhood of poor students and menial workers. Schlafstadt's many shops sell books, antiques, used furniture, tools, and weapons. The book vendors cater mainly to university faculty and students, but they also attract customers from across Altdorf and beyond. East of the university complex are private clubs, administrative buildings, and townhouses rented by junior professors and middle-class students. The constant ruckus from the Street of 100 taverns makes the Eastern District a less desirable place to live. After business hours, buildings are locked securely against burglary attempts by drunken students and weird-root addicts. Most of the fights that break out in Schulergent involve gangs of rakish young noblemen and drunken tavern patrons. And once you enter this place, of course, you know, the atmosphere changes completely. You are now surrounded mostly by students, by, you know, people working either at the university or in some other place of learning. Of course, this is also patrolled. There are, you know, guard patrols, just patrolling the streets, making sure that everything is in order, that no one gets into any sort of trouble. And Lambert is just asking, you know, the Ackner woman. Gustav and Johannes, you are supporting him naturally. Few people, unfortunately, you know, they were saying, "Oh no, I've never heard of her. I don't know her. Never saw her. No." And you know, then one other person said, Ackner, I think I've heard about her. She's some kind of a visitor from..." You're back? Oh no, it's I think it's the dog. "She's some kind of visitor from Nauen, I believe, or somewhere south, I'm not sure." And then finally... Was that the background?
I think it might be... I wonder if it's...
Lambert?
I wonder if it's if his mic is picking up something while
okay.
he's on the phone.
No, it's all fine. Anyway, then you've asked, you know, an owner of a rather luxurious-looking shop selling selling expensive glassware, and he says, "Gurin Ackner, oh, of course, I know who she is. She's a patron of culture, of arts. Our city has great honor that she actually, you know, stays in its premises. I believe she lives near the palace, near the Emperor's palace, on the other side of the river." And he, you know, whispers in a rather conspiratorial way, "I've heard that she rents a house near the Palace of Retribution," he says.
Sounds like a lovely place.
He looks at you. "You're not from around here, are you, boy?"
Well, I was just going to roll. Do I know what the Palace of Retribution is?
You can roll plus 10% Common Knowledge Empire.
Okay. Oh, I built it.
Yeah, let me quickly tell you what the pass of retribution is. You've heard about this place, Johannes. Near the Emperor's Palace and the Temple of Sigmar, there is a group of austere stone buildings, and these are the courts of justice, but they are universally known as the Pass of Retribution in Altdorf. No one in the city wants to end up there, sitting under the stern gaze of a judge. While each courtroom does contain symbols of Verena that promise justice, the judges are known for harsh sentences, far outweighing the seriousness of the crimes. Those caught looting, for example, are almost certain to receive a death sentence in the Palace of Retribution. And while the complex contains many buildings, the most important are the Imperial Courthouse and the Tower of Altdorf. But other than... that's all you know right now. Yeah. This is like, cool. You know, the scary place of Altdorf.
Okay, great.
And he...
Him into our buddy.
Yeah, and he just, you know, winks at you after saying that. Lambert, you've passed, and you've been told where Gorin Akner is staying.
Okay.
Lambert?
I don't think he's back.
Okay. Oh, because I think that he's back. Okay. Well, anyway, it took you like an hour and a half to learn this stuff.
Yeah.
And you are relatively close to the university. So?
You said there was a merchants that we were passing?
You're in Altdorf. You're constantly passing shops, street stalls, you know, stuff like that.
I'd like to get some healing draughts.
Okay. What's the... let me quickly see. What's the availability of the healing draught?
Making its routine.
Because you are right now in the university average district, so we'll do this. We'll give this minus 10%, so one, one level less. In that case, you need to.
I think it's standard at average, right?
I don't think that in this place it would be standard. You are not in a place normally, you know, which would normally sell things like that.
I'm rolling again. Fellowship? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's for fellowship, I believe.
I have a 34 fellowship.
You want to reroll?
Yeah, I'll use the luck. I have 2 luck left then.
Okay.
Oh, okay. No healing draughts today.
You can't find any shop that sells draughts here. And you are even being told that, why are you looking for things like that here, miner? It's not like students need healing draughts, right? You know, which, truth be told, there is something to it.
Well, I don't know, guys. What do you think? Since we're already here in the university district, should we try to find out about this Red Dragon Club and Golden Triangle?
Yeah.
Alright. Sure. More gossiping.
where do you want to go?
You said there was one part that had all the clubs and taverns, right?
Or are they separate? Yes, but you remember that the Red Dragon was on the grounds of the university.
Mm-hmm. Oh, so, okay.
Of the university itself. The okay. Golden Triangle, you're not mm-hmm. sure if it's even here. Maybe it's in some other place. Remember?
Maybe the Explorers Guild would be more on paper, so to speak. You know what I mean?
I think let's just since we're on the university right now or near it, let's just walk through the university and ask them about, you know, hey, you know, any parties happening, you know, the Red Dragon Club, blah, blah.
Yeah, the university, by the way, is here. number okay. 7. It's even
okay, cool.
named on, you know, it's even on the map. Lambert, you here?
Okay. Yeah, I'm here.
So you've been given the sort of address of Gurin Arknar. She's on the she lives supposedly on the other side of the river, near the Palace of Retribution, which is near the Emperor's Palace, by the way. And she's apparently from Nonn. And now the guys want to find the Red Dragon, and they also want to find the Golden Triangle.
Mm-hmm. So the probably best from Johanna is because you're closer in age to these whippersnappers.
Mm-hmm. Sounds good.
I think I'm only a few years older than you, but when you're young, it seems like a lifetime.
Yeah. Mm-hmm, yep. All right. So shall I start gossiping?
Wait. So you are going to university itself, or are you just gossiping right now on the streets?
How do you do?
I thought we were in the university.
No, you were in the university district. You were not in the university per se. The university takes roughly, as I said, a third of Schulergegend, but okay. It's not just university. But of course, you see the complex, because it's not a single building, a huge complex that is the University of Aldorf.
So I think what I'll do is I'll ask once on the way towards the university, and then once we get inside, if that's doable.
Sure. About the Red Dragon, yes?
Yeah.
Okay, so roll me just roll normally. But it will take you about 20 minutes of asking on the street. Okay. You wrote. Yeah.
Yep,
you've caught a group of, of young students. Dressed rather well, you guess that they're not nobility, but they're probably from the, from some kind of rich merchant families, stuff like that. They are, of course, holding, a handful of scrolls, of books. When you approach them with your friends in tow, you hear that right now they are very excited because they have a break, a few hours break, and they intend to spend the break in one of the many, many inns and taverns in this place, of course, having a good time, which probably means drinking. You ask them about the Red Dragon, and one of them says, "Oh, a dragon! I never heard of that. Like, what's a Red Dragon?" The other says, "No, I never heard about this. I don't know. I don't know." And finally, like the last one, he says, "Oh. Yeah, the Red Dragon Club. You're one of them. You're one of them explorer types, eh?"
Something like that.
Yeah.
Explorer adjacent.
Yeah, it's. I've heard that it's run by the what's it called? The Guild of Explorers. Oh, it's on the. It's in the university. You need to go there, and there, and essentially just gives you the directions. It's on the bottom floor of this and that building, stuff like that. You can't miss it. And after that they say, "Oh, sorry, we need to go. We have things to discuss, academic things to discuss."
All right. Well, let's maybe go and verify that it's that we know where it is, and then let's also ask for the Golden Triangle on the way.
On the way, you want to also ask about the Golden Triangle. All right, but who are you asking about this?
Students.
Any particular kind, or just students in general?
I think we should probably try to ask the cartography students in particular, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, it's not like, cartography students are walking with a sign cartography on their chests.
They're not walking with maps on their heads?
No, sadly not.
Carrying clothes?
No.
All right, well, we'll just ask about it. I'm just going to ask about it.
Okay. But in that case, you have minus 15% bonus.
Okay.
Your
Well, yeah, that's not good.
You're doing it.
All right, I'll use the luck on that one.
Mm-hmm. You want support from your friends?
Bam! All
right.
Okay.
I think he's all right.
Yeah. As you are approaching one of the few gates leading to the University of Altdorf, you've caught the attention of you've actually caught one of the more noble-looking students, you guess, and also an older one. He's dressed very well, you know. He has this this like white sleeves on his shirt, and you know, very fancy looking boots with silver clasps. And you know, when you ask him and want to speak to him, he looks at you in this, you know this, Johannes, and you probably don't like this, in this very haughty way, you know, this like, oh, for plebeians, you know, but he says like, yes, how can I help you? I don't have much time, dear fellow. If you could please tell me quickly, what do you want from me? I don't have any money, by the way. I can't help you. I'm sorry. Well, man, spit it out.
I got to play this right. We have these invitations, and we're looking for the Golden Triangle. Do you know where it's located?
Oh, the Golden Triangle. Well, why didn't you said this immediately? Yes, it's located in the southern part of the city, near the southern gate, actually, right next to the walls. Well, you have an invitation. I am impressed. They don't invite just anyone. And he just looks you up and down, like he's very surprised and just very, you know, genuinely just shocked that someone like you would get an invitation to a place like that. Just a word of advice, good man. I would suggest wearing something much more much cleaner when you are going to visit this place.
Yes, I have an appointment with a tailor.
Oh, very good, very good. And maybe get a bath or two or five.
Word to the wise. So what I want to do now is I want to
shoot him.
Try to
Hold up. No, okay, fine.
What? Sorry, Lambert. What was that?
I was saying, like, is he just saying that because he's like a noble prick?
Or yeah.
Is he...
Yeah.
Mostly, but we also
he can't be part of the. I know. Can't be part of the Guild of Explorers and be clean all the time. Like, you're an explorer. If you're clean all the time, the only thing you're fucking exploring is like the local brothel.
Or you call yourself an explorer and you hang out with other people that call themselves explorers.
Yeah, all you gotta do
we don't know that he's an explorer. He's just a rich.
Yeah.
He's just a rich dude.
You don't know.
All you gotta do is, you know, wear.
But anyway, I'm trying to work my doom in here, guys.
Wait.
My bad.
Okay.
So what I'd like to do.
Mm-hmm. Giannis, go.
So what I'd like to do is.
What you'd
is,
like to doom?
I'd like to doom. Is that where you raise one hand and no? Okay. I want to try to sneeze or blow snot in my hand, and then go, "Oh, thank you, my good man," and pat him on the shoulder.
All right, but it will take. I mean, he's in front of you, looking at you. If you want to do this, it's going to take a minus 30 dexterity test. Because you would have to be blind not to fucking see what you're doing.
I'm gonna try.
If you botch, you don't want to botch.
Okay. Well. I just fail.
No, I mean, you just sneeze into your hand. He looks at, he looks at you with this look of distaste on his face. He takes a few steps back. Oh, for Sigmar's sake, so uncouth, he says.
That was really uncouth.
Out of my way, you plebeians. And, you know, he just walks
Is
past.
Is that plebeian?
Whatever. Like, plebeians.
That was Lambert actively correcting him.
Okay. he looks at you with this rather, you know, nasty look on his face, but he's not saying anything. He just walks past you and, you know, disappears into the crowd.
Emperor's Reichspiel.
How do you like them apples?
It'll be funnier. It'll be funnier. You figure out he's a Reichspiel major. Oh, I'm getting my doctorate in English.
Yeah, so anyway, you have the sort of address of the Golden Triangle Club, which apparently is a very fancy place. Mm-hmm. Although you would probably realize that it is based on the invitations, as I said before, last session.
It's like gold leaf.
Yeah, gold leaf, very nice paper, you know, paper, not parchment. And they are written in a beautiful way, just, you know, it's like an art, honestly. But you are close to the university. You are actually right at the gates of the university. What do you guys want to do now?
Well, since we're already here, guys, let's just go look for this Red Dragon Club place.
Okay.
And see what's going on.
Come on,
man. Agreed.
Okay. So, now let me very quickly describe the university, because it is important. And I just like exposition. I'm like an exposition man. I just read a lot.
You like exposing yourself.
Yes, I am exposing myself, but only in a nearby park, naturally. And only, and only after dark. But wait, what? sorry, that's
well, in the US, that means you're a politician. Yeah, this means you're a politician.
Okay. Aldorf is said.
Is your last name Wiener?
No. No.
His last name is Danger.
Wasn't it Wiener that exposed himself?
Yes, but his name.
Oh, he was sending dick pics. That was right.
Yeah, he was sending dick pics under the name Carlos Danger.
Just say you're an alcoholic and you can get away with it.
Okay.
Oh my god. Alright.
Well. Nice. I thought when you were saying Wiener, I thought it had something to do with a dick joke.
No, the guy's name.
It is.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, his name was
He's a
Wiener,
U.S. House representative.
Okay. Nice.
And his wife was like a high-up Democratic political operative in New York City.
Oh, Jesus.
She was in bed next to him with their kid when he sent that picture, too.
Oh wow. Are you fucking kidding me?
Jesus.
I didn't know that. And then after he apologized and said he would stop and all that.
He did it again.
Jesus.
I just send pictures of Nixon and people to people. And it's like, here's my dick pic.
Like 16-year-olds and shit.
Oh, no. Ah, sweet. I ain't sending Nixon to a 16-year-old.
No, I'm saying Anthony Weiner did. Like, it was like he couldn't make it up. He just kept doing it.
Jesus.
Your name is Wiener. You really need to watch it.
Yeah.
That's a dick joke right there. No worries. That's a good story. Aldorf is said to be the first center of learning in the Empire. Although the University of Known is technically an older building, a tradition of sharing knowledge and keeping records is said to have been practiced in Sigmar's Reichdorf. Today, the walled university complex is one of the Empire's famous wonders. 5 gates provide access to a sprawling maze of lecture halls, dormitories, and office buildings. A confusing array of staircases connect the multi-tiered open quads where students hurry between classes. Visitors without guides are bound to become disoriented. The university's 5 most prestigious colleges are those of law, medicine, yes, I know, military, history, alchemy, and bestiara. Known is generally considered to have superior faculties of mathematics, science, philosophy, theology, and literature. However, Aldorf is somewhat less exclusive, making it more accessible to middle-class students. The diversity of the student body encourages vibrant intellectual discourse, and nearby street of 100 taverns is abuzz with academic debate. That's actually true. You guys, when you ever since you started living there, there are lots of students. Every single day, every single night. Minor gods and their esoteric cults are also find favor with the students. Agitators compete for attention at the adjunct temple of Borgbach and the columned hall of the university sanctuary to the classical god Cleo houses archaeological finds discovered in and around Aldorf. A Meister represents the professors of each college and reports to the Chancellor and Vice Chancellor. Meisters are concerned with securing as much financing for their faculty as possible from the Chancellor's office. The Commission of Procuration handles admission, funding and discipline. The university employs its own watchmen, called porters, and enforces night curfews with a variable degree of success. The gates are closed during curfew hours, but adventurous students have found that sections of the wall are easy to climb down from within, although getting back inside can be difficult. And that's that. Yeah, so you enter through one of the gates into the university, yes?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, sorry.
No worries. The sea of people here is like, oh, it's a literal sea. Mostly students just hurrying either, you know, to grab something to eat between classes or to actually, you know, take part in their next lecture. You, of course, hear fevered academic discussions, both from younger and older people, professors and their charges. The whole building is honestly very well made, very well maintained, huge. It's like, really, remember, one third of this entire quarter is dedicated to a single building, technically. So it's like ginormous. And unfortunately, there are like signs where to go, like, for example, you know, lecture halls 1 to 50, stuff like that. Or, you know, the botanic garden, or library minorum, library majorum, the chapel of Verena, who, remember, is also, of course, the goddess of learning, stuff like that. But even so, you almost immediately know that you get lost here. What do you guys want to do?
Not get lost.
That's actually a good idea.
Yeah.
Explorers Guild, right?
Well, wait.
See any sign for the Explorers Guild.
I felt like the guy gave us, like, explicit directions on how to get to the Red Dragon Club.
Yes.
In the south of the city, though, right?
No, south of the city is the Golden Triangle.
The first guy. So I would like to head to the Red Dragon if I know where I'm going.
Let me put it this way. Yes, he gave you the explicit directions. That said, you're here for the very first time, and this is a maze. Mm. You roll me plus 30% because he gave you directions. Intelligence test. I presume that Gustav and Lambert, you're on his heels.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No problem. Yeah.
Does anybody have navigate?
Yeah. Truth be told, it should be a navigate test, but I think given the circumstances and, you know, the directions, a basic intelligence test suffices. But yes, navigation skill is rather useful, let's just say. But it takes you like 10 minutes of brisk walk. But eventually, you know, between a few major buildings of the university, holding, you know, grand halls for students to gather in and listen to their professors, you found a series like of small buildings, some of them administrative, others look like they're more for, you know, maybe storing various objects used during classes and you know, generally used like for running this place, in like, if you'd be trying to put this in our world, it would be like janitor's quarters, essentially. But also there's a small single level building. Honestly, very small. It's probably the size of the main hall in the Shepherd's Wand. Made almost entirely from wood, showing clear signs of age. And there's a sign above the entrance. The sign shows a rather crudely painted red drake holding a mug in one of its claws and winking at the at people who are, you know, who are looking at it. And of course there's the sign, the Red Dragon pub.
All right, poultry.
Gentlemen, let's go inside and wet our whistle.
Is that a sex thing?
Yes, I call my penis my whistle.
I mean,
blow it.
It's a pretty good one.
Yeah.
Pretty good whistle.
Okay, so you enter the place. The door leading inside are actually open wide, and as you approach it, you can smell the you know, telltale smell of cheap ale, the affordable drink for any student. Of honestly not so good food, like, you know, the grease has been used for a few days now to fry different things, and you know, it's
I've
never
been to a college bar.
Yeah, it's never been changed. But also there are other strange smells. You smell something like perhaps incense or some kind of herbs burning.
Anything that smells like the Crimson Shade from before?
No, it's clear. It's, okay. It's for sure not. It's not a Crimson Shade for sure. No, it's more like a herbalist is, you know, is like built his stand inside and just, you know, burns herbs and incense to ward off illness and foul humors. Inside
smells strongly. Smells like weed.
Yes, exactly. And there's a 420 sign above the entrance.
Yes.
Blaze. Yeah, blaze it every day, bro. No.
By the way, Snoop Dogg supposedly is giving up smoking.
He said that before, though.
Yeah, I don't.
You just believe it, man.
Yeah, I don't believe that. I think he's.
We've been down this road before.
Yeah, I think he's partially made from weed at this point.
Yeah,
so
that I believe.
Yeah. Anyway, when you enter inside, first of all, the place doesn't have any windows, so inside it's very gloomy. It's also very smoky, and by that I mean that there's this constant, like, you know, curtain of smoke hanging in the air. It's tobacco mixed with the smoke from the kitchen, mixed with those strange herbs, which are actually, you see, they are burning in braziers hanging from the ceiling. And almost immediately your head starts to hurt. You essentially are getting migraine. Light at first, but you know that if you stay here long enough, it's going to get unpleasant. There are lots of people here also, students mainly, although you see a few older people in long togas, which probably indicates that they are professors or maybe, you know, supporting teachers. There is a long bar at the end. Behind the bar is a lone man. He has long, rather unusual looking hair, because his hair is like in those like put into those long braids. He also has
pleated.
Yeah, he also has equally pleated beard. And he's chatting up with a few people, you know, at the bar. From what you've gathered, this place is mainly for discussion and drinking. There's only few people eat, and it's clear from the look on their faces, even though it's, you know, gloomy, that the food here is just like passable. When you've entered, no one is giving you any looks. No one even, you know, just noticed that you went inside. Oh, by the way, sorry, one last thing. Lots of maps on the walls. Lots of maps behind actual glass glass frames. Maps of the Empire, maps of probably provinces of the Empire, but also even from few glances you see that some of the maps are describing some faraway lands. You're not sure which. What? Whatever. But you know what I mean.
What do you think, fellas? Should we ask the barkeep if he's seen or if he's seen Gaston around, or if he knows Gaston? What do you think?
I mean, this is your show, bud. You tell me.
Okay.
No, I'm being dead serious. Like,
if lead on, Duff, I get it.
Yeah.
All right. I walk up to the bar.
I'll walk up with you.
Wait, I'm coming. Just had to.
Just had to pour myself a cup of tea. You're approaching the bar, yes?
Yes.
Okay.
You
approach the bar. The few people who are sitting there, they're just chatting with the bartender. They're laughing, but then the bartender looks at you and he says, "Wait, well, customers, man, customers." And he looks at you. Oh, welcome to Red Dragon. How can I help you today? You look like
Rastafari. Yes.
You look like you're not from here, eh?
What's your weirdest alcohol?
My weirdest alcohol? What do you mean, like the strongest or like the?
Oh, this is the Explorers Guild, right? You got shit from far away.
No,
right?
Man, it's not Explorers Guild. Oh, for fuck's sake, another one who's mistaking that. No, Explorers Guild. They meet in my place, but this ain't Explorers Guild. No, I mean they're cool, they're fine people. Always meeting here, discussing stuff, discussing their travels and the strange places that they've visited, and they brought all those maps here, man. You see those maps? And he points at the maps. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so so I like them a lot. I mean
this guy high?
You're not sure. I mean, he's very strange. He's also strangely dressed. He's dressed in a very outlandish manner, completely non-imperial.
Can I do a perception test to tell if he is acting the same way that Dunkmar was acting?
Sure.
Because Dunkmar was obviously hitting his own shit.
This guy is dressed in red, green, and gold, right?
Yeah, there we go, baby.
No, you're not. You don't think that he's on the same staff as Dunkmar, but you have a feeling that first of all, he's weird, and that he might be intoxicated in some way.
Gotcha.
We have as for the drinks, we have red beer. We have peach juice. We have mulberry wine. Dwarf Dark Ale and Blackberry Brandy. We have.
How much is your Dwarf Dark Ale?
Dwarf Dark Ale, man, is like, this is good stuff. So like, it's a silver shilling per jug.
Don't believe
I'll take.
I really don't believe.
So how much is in a jug? Is that one serving?
In a jug? Oh, it's,
yeah.
There's like a lot.
Okay, well, we'll take one jug and three glasses, please.
Dwarf Dark Ale coming right up, he says. And he
disappears.
Yeah, and he disappears.
I am beyond skeptical that this is Dwarven Dark Ale for that price. And my halfling palate is about to be pissed off.
He disappears behind behind the door, behind the counter. The few people who are at the counter, they look at you. They're drinking something. One of them smokes pipe. They're not saying anything. They just look at you. Sean, you were saying something.
Well, I whisper to Lambert, don't piss this guy off. We need to ask him some questions.
All right.
The guy emerges from behind the counter and places the, you know, a large, actually very nice looking ceramic jug on the counter. He also places three large steel steins with a stamped symbol of a red dragon. I mean, sorry, of a dragon, not actually no red dragon because it's painted. And he says, oh, by the way, I am Clodomiro Klemperer.
Clodomiro Klemperer.
Here's his name.
Oh, Jesus.
Oh, okay. Fuck that.
But people call me Clodo the Wise.
So,
because I am wise beyond my years.
Yeah. Yes, I can see that.
Yeah.
I can see the wisdom just
like
emanating from you.
Like, you know, I just think about something and then I can't stop thinking about it and I'm just, you know, I'm just in this completely other world where time has no meaning and only me and my thoughts exist. And I, like, think about stuff.
Rad. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's hey, really deep.
That's fucking rad, dude.
I know. It's pretty radical, right?
Hey, Clodo.
Yeah?
We're looking for our friend, Gaston Schnitzer.
Oh, Gaston. 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 He's your friend? Oh, man. Tell Gaston never, ever to walk into my place again, man. Not after the fucking last time he was here. He just wrecked the place. You know, the fucking, the porters had to be called, you know? They had to drag his ass out. It was completely not radical.
We had heard that he'd been acting the fool, and we were looking for him to try to calm him down.
Oh, man, this is, like, I can't believe why those, they're not fools, they're cool people, but, you know, the guys and gals from the Explorers Guild, why they tolerate his bullshit, man? Like, Gaston is just, I've heard, and he just, you know, he goes all conspiratorial-like, that he's been juicing, you know? That he's been hitting the pipe. You know,
I just pipe up. Like, I am woefully out of style with the lingo here. What do you mean?
Well, I mean that he's taking drugs, man.
Oh, okay. And I lean across the bar, and I just sort of say, like, Red Shadow.
I don't know, man. I'm look.
Wait, stop it.
What? Sorry?
I'm sorry, my dog's been licking at the leg and it's driving me fucking nuts.
I thought you were yelling at me.
Stop it.
Stop. I'm sorry.
Stop it, Lambert. Stop.
I'm sorry, I just wanted a taste.
Clodomiro says, man, look at me. Do I look like someone who uses drugs?
Yes.
Oh.
What?
Not at all. You look like someone of refined taste and, you know, you're wise.
Oh, yeah. That,
why would...
You get that. I like... What's your name, man?
Johannes.
Johannes. And what about you, little fella? He asks you, Lambert.
Lambert.
All right. And what about you?
I'm like not even looking at the guy, Oleg.
Oleg, you don't look like Oleg to me. But whatever. Yeah. So, no, man, I'm not juicing. But I've heard that, you know, Gaston got in some bad crowd, you know. I don't know, man. He was cool, you know. He was very ambitious. I think he was studying geography or cartography or some other fee. I don't know, man. Like, and you know, he was actually people were inviting him, like people from the Guild of Explorers, you know, who were meeting here because, like, the guild, they don't have a fixed place of meetings, you know. They meet sporadically and, you know, in various places. One of them is here, of course, Red Dragon, best place in town. Yeah, visit every time that you come around. Anyway, you know, he was, they were inviting him, but then, well, you know, and he, like, even in his state, you see that he starts to realize that he's probably speaking a bit too much. Anyway, how's the beer?
Oh, it's great.
Actually, yeah, the beer, sorry, the beer actually is very good. I'm not even kidding. It's actually very tasty.
This, I had beer at a dwarven establishment. Is it close?
No, it's very good, but it's nowhere close.
It's obviously a human beer.
You're saying that?
No, I'm not. You're telling me that this is not close to what I had at the dwarven establishment.
No, it's not. The dwarven beers are various. I mean, it's hard, you know, hard to describe the taste. They are very essential, but they are also very, like, fulfilling. Sometimes when you drink dwarven beer, you almost feel like you're having a meal. That's one of their descriptions. They're just, you know, the taste is just almost impossible to duplicate. And while this beer is very good, it's nowhere near the drink that you had in the dwarven quarter.
Dwarven beer is a porter, and this is just a brown ale.
Yeah, we can say that.
All right.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Mm-hmm, Johannes.
Well, I'm not disappointed. This is actually good.
Okay. Calodomiro, before we let you go, to deal with your other customers. You're saying you got in with a bad group. A bad group of guild members or some other people.
You see that Clodomiro. By the way, first of all, you see that, you know, right now you're the only people, like, left at the bar. The guys who were, like, eyeing you before, they just got up and left. Probably, you know, went to their class. Second thing, you see that Clodomiro is, like, you know, he's very enthusiastically wiping the counter and looking away from you. Like, pretending that he's not hearing what you're saying, you guess? Because he's not reacting in any way.
Time for a charm roll.
Yes, time for a charm roll, if you want.
You want to tell me.
Clodomiro, I can...
Oh, son of a bitch.
I cannot...
I'm gonna roll a second look.
I cannot charm you in any way.
and I still can't charm you. Yeah. Well, at least I didn't watch.
Clodomiro is like saying...
Hey.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, what you are saying?
I'm gonna say, hey, pud puller.
he's like saying, oh yeah, you know what? Maybe I don't know what I'm talking about sometimes. You know, it's just like this place doesn't have the right ventilation. I wanted to install windows for some time, but you know, there was never a good opportunity. You know that stuff. Gustav Lambert, if you want to charm him, you can try. That said, after Johannes try, you will have a minus 10%.
All right,
let's try.
I'll give it a shot.
Wait, so who's trying? Because
I'll give it a shot.
Okay,
Cluedo, you've been forthright, man. I know I was a little bit salty when I came in, but I've been looking for a good solid drink. I've been looking for a good solid drink in the establishment, and you've offered both and the best conversation I've had in a while. Yeah, boy.
Nice. Actually, I just want to say, Gustav, that you can support Lambert if you want. You know,
don't think he needs it.
Yeah, but of course he doesn't really need it. You know, your honeyed words, Lambert. Actually, they strike where they where they're supposed to. Claude Amore looks at you and says, "Really? Like, you like the drinks? Well, thanks, man. Like this beer, it's you know, not many people can afford it. I mean, lots of poor students here, but glad that you like it."
I don't want to be that guy, but I look around the room. How many people are in here?
Right now, aside from you, probably like a dozen.
All right, so I'll go ahead and pick up 4 more jugs of this beer for the rest to share in the establishment.
Okay, so you're
put us on good terms.
You're ordering 4 jugs of this beer for everyone here, yes?
Yes.
And Claude Miro looks at you and he says, "Ladies and gentlemen, this here fine Lambert, the halfling, just bought you all 4 jugs of dark brown, of dark dwarf beer."
He messed up.
And, you know, the people here, they turn around, they look at him, they look at you, they wink a few times, almost like they can't believe what they've heard, and they're like, "Woo, yeah, baby!" You know, just.
And they're gonna fail these fucking exams.
Yeah, and of course, you know, they rush towards the bar. They grab your hand, Lambert, and yours, Gustav, and your Johannes. You know, they shake your hands, pat you on the shoulders. "Thanks, thank you so much, thanks, you're the best, woo, yeah, woo," you know, stuff.
That should ease this conversation a little bit.
Yeah, and meanwhile, Claude Miro prepares the jugs, and after, you know, the last person expresses their gratitude towards all of you, he goes from behind the bar and just, you know, puts the jugs on the tables with glasses. This gives you guys a few, probably like a minute, maybe less, to quickly discuss things if you want.
Go now, do it.
Do what?
Ask the questions you want to talk.
Oh, I thought you were asking him.
No, okay, I'm not. I'll ask you, dude.
Okay, I say. So I guess I take it none of these guys, all these guys are good people, not those bad people that were negatively influencing our friend Gaston.
Oh no! They are those people here, very fine, all students, all decent. You know, even the ones who are studying mathematics, like, I mean, fuck mathematics, everyone knows that. But yeah, they're just great, man. They're just great. No. I've heard that. I've heard that Gaston, you know, he just, you know him. Like, he was. He liked women.
Fuck Gene.
Yeah, that was his. That was his nickname. Fuck machine. Just, like, you know, laughs in this very obnoxious manner. Like, you know, someone who still laughs at the word penis when they're in their 30s. Yes!
Hey, shut up. Fuck you.
Yeah, I was going to say. And your point is?
yeah, exactly. Anyway. You know, I've... And he was, like, betting all sorts of gals, you know, also all sorts of broads. And like few of them, no, sorry, actually one of them, he met here, you know, a foreign student, I think. And I was serving them. It was like a few weeks ago. I don't remember how many, but a few weeks ago, they met here to discuss, you know, their travels. Who saw what, you know, there were a few navigators from the, you know, who were actually sailing with our fleet, like the Empire's fleet. I don't know if it was like first or second fleet, I don't remember. I have no idea, but whatever, you know. And Gaston was there, and he was with this lady, and she was like, "Oh man, like that piece of ass. She was handsome. I mean, gorgeous. Like, really. But, you know, she was giving everyone this stink eye, you know? Like, she was better than everyone else. And I mean, there was something strange about her, you know? Like, she was tall. And she was very haughty. And she had this curious accent. I even asked her where she's from. And she told me that she's somewhere south. Stuff like that. But then, you know, she told me to ask less questions and just bring them what they want. You know, just, because that's what I'm here for, right? That's what they're paying me for. So, you know, so I did.
She was rude. You're saying a rude foreigner.
Yeah, like, I mean, but yeah, she was like, you know, foreigner. There are lots of foreigners here, man. Like, this is the university. We have Thailians, we have Estalians, we have people from Kislev, you know, even a few Arabians. So, like, I know lots of foreigners. But she was like no foreigner I ever saw. She was just strange. And, you know, I watched them from the counter, from behind the counter. And everyone at the table, they were listening to her, mainly speaking. Like, she was telling them the stories about the lands that she saw. They were talking quietly, so I only heard snippets. I heard about some place called I don't know, somewhere. Apparently, it's some kind of a place completely covered in some kind of forest. There was the mention of.
Would
the,
I know about Lustia from?
No, you would need to have navigation. You would need to have common knowledge, Lustia. There were some, you know, talks about, of course, about this like cafe. Apparently, she visited. The its capital, and you know, normally when someone says stuff like that, you don't believe them, you know, because like it's like bullshit, you know, that people say that just to, you know, act like they're hot stuff. But here's the thing, and he looks at you, when she was telling those things, you know, when she was telling those things, even though they were talking quietly and I barely was able to understand what she was saying in this strange melodic voice of hers, I believed her, you know? Oh, and she was dressed weirdly as well. Like, really weirdly.
Is she wearing a black cape with red lining?
Nah. I mean, she was wearing a dark set of clothes. Very expensive looking, very fine. No, I think they were... they were like... Dark purple, I think. Dark purple and mixed with red. And she also had this rather strange headdress on her head. She had very nice looking long raven black hair, you know, falling right to the middle of her back, straight. They contrasted very nicely with her pale face. But she had this, like, bandana, maybe, I don't know, some kind of a cap that was almost completely covering her head. I never saw anything like that, but, you know, I'm not a I'm not a fashion expert, right? He takes a swig from a mug of beer. So, yeah, and anyway, she was with Gaston. It was clear that she was with Gaston, yeah? Because, you know, he was holding her hand and she sometimes, you know, patted him on the head like you would a puppy. Sometimes caressed his cheek. He was, like, completely entranced with her. And, you know, and he once again lowers his voice. But that's the thing. When some of the people in the, you know, at the meeting, when they were saying something to her, asking her, you know, about the stuff that she saw, the places that she visited, even from the counter, I saw that Gaston was giving them a rather nasty look, you know? A few times I almost swore that he was ready to get up and start swinging. And yeah, and you know, he brought quite a few chicks here over the last like 2 years when during you know which he was studying, and he never acted like that. Then again, those were just your ordinary, you know, student girls and bar wenches, stuff like that, right? So yeah, that's
very interesting.
After that, he came one last time. He says, Clodomiro says, and you see that there's you hear pain in his voice and there's a sadness in his eyes. And sadly, I had to call the porters because he came here, ordered a drink. He was clearly stoned. I don't know. You know what he took, what kind of drug he took, but he had this aggression in him, like pent-up aggression, and I gave him a drink, he took the drink, and he took only a sip before he splashed the rest in the face of one of my customers, you know, and then started beating him with the mug. I actually still have the mug, he says, and you hear that he's rummaging through things behind the counter, and he actually takes out the same looking mug as the one that he gave you, but you see that this one is actually dented in a few places. Yeah, you see? Like, he almost cracked the skull of this poor kid. After that, you know, the porters came, they escorted him. The kid went to the infirmary. I've heard that. I mean, I honestly, except for the fact that I would never allow him into my place, I've asked a few people and I've heard that he was skipping classes for some time now, you know, and that there were other violent incidents with him and other students and even, you know, the staff, the university staff. So, yeah. That's that, right?
Oh, that's too bad. You didn't catch the lady's name, did you?
Yeah, I think one of them called her Gurina, Guarina, something like that.
Okay.
That's a unique name.
Yeah, that's like never heard about. I mean, it's not like Clodomiro, like, right?
Yeah, Clodomiro just rolls off the tongue.
I know, man. Like smooth, like milk from a titty.
Boys, I gotta end it soon here.
Sorry, what?
Gotta end it here soon.
Sure. Yeah. Okay. We'll be ending soon. How much time do you have?
I've got about 10 minutes.
Okay, yeah, sure. So, Clodomiro says, you know, as he returns to his work, I hope that this helped a bit.
You know what? It helped so much. Have another silver on me.
Alright, I'll take it, but, he says as he takes silver from you, next time you three come here, the first rounds, no matter what you order, are on me, alright?
Clodomiro, I think you've got my favorite bar in the entire city.
Thank you, man. Thank you. And with that, you know, he nods at you and returns to his work, leaving you alone at the counter.
Well, that went well.
Yeah. Hey, we didn't...
It only cost me 8 silver, man.
Nobody threatened to kill us.
Yeah.
And we had a nice beverage, and we're on to this Guarina chick who I'm getting worried that she is something that rhymes with vampire.
Oh, really?
I don't know.
Again, what is this fucking monster of the week?
Yes, it is. Sorry, that's a carryover from all my other characters that were also paranoid about vampires.
I know, I remember Leopold. Gustav, are you saying anything?
No.
You're just digesting what you've heard. All right, I get that. All right, so in that case, we can end this here. At the Red Dragon, when you are, finishing the last of your beer, and next time we'll pick up here. Remember, this is still pretty early. It's like, I believe, before noon. So yeah. Okay, so let's go straight to the points. For today's session, everyone gets 70 points. For your characters, everyone gets 10 points because you all roleplay very well. For your place of birth, Gustav, what about you? What about Marienburg? I'll give you 10 points. You mentioned that you're not part of the Empire, but you are in this, like, you are in this together, essentially. Yeah, that you're...
Destiny.
What? Sorry?
I said, like, the destinies of the Empire and Marienburg are intertwined.
Yeah, I really like that. Johannes, Reikland?
I kept on trying to say that, Altdorf is the best, and why would anybody want to leave here?
I like that, right,
I'm sort of shitting on the mood a little bit.
Okay, I like that, 10 points for you, very nice. And Lambert, 10 points, because you also mentioned mood.
I was shitting on Altdorf, yeah.
Yeah, you mentioned the Vampire Wars. Yeah, you've mentioned the Vampire Wars, very nice. Religion, Gustav, your religion?
I tried converting.
You didn't try very hard.
We had a conversation about it.
Okay. And I think you also mentioned that no killing, right? That ideally you should deal with Dankmar without killing him.
That's actually Renald and Salia. I wasn't being specific to one. They have kind of the same rules, you know?
I have no intentions of personally being the one to kill my uncle. That's fucked up.
Allowing him to be killed when you have the ability to stop it, or...
How big
he
how
definitely
big
doesn't
the
have the
doing?
Ability to stop
it. I don't have the ability to stop it.
Yeah, I also remember, Gustav, that you were showing the sign of Ronald one time. So, yeah, 10 points for you. Johannes, very nice. Sigmarite... dogma, hold it with the jokes about Sigmar, stuff like that, that the Templars protect you from evil. I like that a lot, 10 points. And Lambert, you mentioned Queensberry quite a few times in a very cool way, rather unusual, but I really enjoyed that, so also 10 points for you, of course, maximum possible. Now, star signs, Gustav, what about you?
I was too serious this time. There was too much going on with, angles to consider, I think, of people after us, where I was definitely not the dancer this time.
True.
Oh, that's star sign, yes. But
I think so too. You were a bit too serious. Well, you were serious because the situation is serious, so I understand that. So I don't think any points are in order right now, but that was also very organic play from you, because it's all fun and games until you get shanked by someone in the street. Now, Johannes, what about your star sign?
I'm the Piper.
What's with the pipe again? Or whistle, sorry, my bad.
My tin whistle. I'm trying to think if I actually did any kind of wheeling or dealing today, and
I don't think you honestly did. Actually, wait. Yeah. You didn't. You ordered the beer for a silver shilling.
Yeah.
So, and so that you'd be so you'd have easier time speaking with the guy.
Yeah, that's true.
But other than that, yeah, but I think I'll give you 5 points because actually what Lambert did with the beers for everyone, it would
ease the conversation for the group.
Yeah, that would work very well with you. But I'll give you 5 points, Johannes. Lambert, what about you?
Wyman the anchorite for patience and caution. I swallowed my pride and didn't blow up on my friends, and instead decided to make a peace offering to finally, you know, cool the heads on this. I know that the carryover for some others is, you know, hating vampires and shit. Mine is usually just shitting on Sigmar.
Okay.
But yeah, I was like, it's probably better if I play this out a little bit more cautious.
Okay.
Well, I think he also didn't. You also took my advice and didn't
piss off
the guy about non-dwarven ale.
Yeah, Clodomir Klemper. Yeah, I thought that you were going to say, "Oh, this is no dwarven ale. This is just piss." Stuff like that. Okay, 10 points for you. Sure. Now let's go to dooming. Gustav, what about your doom?
So, up from the cup of corruption. When Lambert said he's starting a gang war, I just left the room and went and got a
bottle
of wine.
I love this. I love this explanation. This is how you make your dooming people. 10 points, Bran. Very good. That's how you do this. Unorthodox and very cool. Johannes, what about you?
Well, the only thing I tried to do was wipe snot on the dandy guy.
You tried. You want to do that? I can give you 5 points for that.
All right, I'll take it.
Lambert, what about you?
I don't actually know. Thy tongue shall be thy undoing. I'm not really sure. Like, I was very good about...
I will give you 10 points. You know why?
Really?
Yeah, you know why? Because you started talking shit about the Empire's major god in a room full of people from the Empire. Well, and one from Marienburg. But even so. And, yeah, and
there's
that...
There's better ways to get smote.
Yeah. I like that, especially since it, produced a reaction from them, especially from Johannes. So I can give you 10 points for that. Plus you talked, some major smack about other things. Then 5 points for Lambert as halfling because, half 5 points for playing a race other than human. Very nice. And did you guys had any ideas that pushed the scenario forward, Gustav?
Me, no, but Lambert might have helped by going to Koenig.
Koenig?
That was last time. And he got points for that already.
But did he get points for it already?
No, he got points for that.
Yeah. I gave him points for that. Mm-hmm.
As bad as it is, I did not intend to possibly incite a gang war.
Yeah. Honestly.
And we talked about this last session. It's like, I really did not want that to happen, but I guess this is just the way the cards are being played.
Honestly, I don't think that there were any ideas today. You all RP'd very well, and you've learned stuff, but no radical ideas like the one with Koenig last time. So I don't think any points should be given for that. But that's it. That's the points. I think that's quite a lot, honestly. You should have at least a single advance from this session available. Okay, and now, sorry, let's quickly before we end discuss our next game. I guess it will be December.
It'll probably be December. Would that be the 3rd?
What about you guys?
The only thing I'm not 100% certain about on the 3rd is, I think I was telling you guys, so I get back to Arizona on the 1st, and then my wife leaves back for California on the 3rd, so I'm assuming she's taking an early flight, but I don't know yet. So that would be the only thing, is that might interfere with me being there on time.
Okay. What about you, Brian?
Third is good for me.
Okay, so we can schedule the game for the third. Sean, as soon as you know anything, tell us, okay?
Yeah. We'll do that.
If the third won't work, then we'll try next possible week.
I think I'm good for the 10th, too, if it comes to that.
Yeah, because I presume that we'll only have a single game in December anyway, because it's always like that. So let's at least make this single game possible, and then, you know, return in January. For now, third it is, okay?
Sounds good.
Awesome. So, thank you, guys.
Later, guys.
See you later, and take care. Bye-bye.
A good game.
Yeah, great game. Good game, guys.